So I'm Gordon Uchenik from Coverity, and a brief presentation on verification and validation of open source software. The first thing about open source is it is absolutely everywhere, even when you think it's not, you're not using it. So this is the results of a study that we had done by Forrester, the consulting group, and you could see that 92% of the software systems, as far as general software systems in general, are using open source. What's also interesting, of course, is that it's over 90% for every possible source that you can think of. So software systems are becoming not only more complex, but they're becoming diverse in terms of their supply chain. That every software system that we put together these days pretty much contains software from a various number of sources, of which open source is just one, and what we're planning to talk about today. So open source in embedded software. So again, according to Gartner, 80% of development will include open source components, especially now with Linux. With Linux being popular in the embedded world. So there you are, you have an open source kernel as well. Now, if you even say things like, well, I'm going to use a proprietary operating system, such as, let's say we have friends here from Wind River and or from their competitors, even those people have adopted certain parts of open source and embrace them into their product for certain things like network stacks or math libraries or things like that. The days where one organization is totally responsible for every bit, byte, and nibble of their software are rapidly disappearing. The last time I saw it was only for one small part of a fly-by-wire aircraft, where only the vehicle management function itself, the ones that were actually reading the inputs, processing the control laws, and then outputting the controls to move flaps and throttles and things like that, where they actually bothered to take the care to write the kernel themselves. That was the last time I saw that, and in a lot of aircraft now we are seeing commodity operating systems being used for something as important as vehicle management. The other systems on aircraft, for example, like the avionics, have long been using commodity or commercial real-time operating systems. So the challenges when using open source is, well, it's there. You take it, and it comes without any guarantees. It comes without pedigree and without knowledge of its provenance. So how much has it been tested? Who tested it? Well, every person who used it tested it according to what their needs were. And it's really impossible to put together a profile of how completely or how rigorously that open source software itself was tested. And you can say, well, Linux, hundreds, millions of users, millions of eyes, ubiquitous all over the world. Well, you still don't know what kind of corner cases they can get into. And the way I like to characterize that is that when you have almost any piece of software, the happy path through the code is well exercised. And the error handling that goes on is less well exercised because it is physically impossible to create the number of test cases that would be necessary to completely anticipate all possible error conditions for any software. That happens in terms of reliability, in terms of correctness, and also in terms of vulnerability, especially for those cases where we have things that fly that have sensitive data. And what is it that adversaries do? They try to understand the assumptions upon which your code is based, the assumptions that you made when you wrote that software, and do whatever they can by injecting errors into the system to make those assumptions false. So when they do that, that's how they penetrate. That's how the penetration testers work. And what is the difference between a reliable software or a vulnerable software or quality and security? Is your enemy God, you know, giving you random facts of nature or failures or incidents that you couldn't anticipate? Or is it a malicious person? You know, and God's smarter. Okay, we like to think so anyway. So put together, we just don't know how well this software has been beat upon, been tested, and proved worthy of inclusion into environments where failure is not acceptable. So, you know, as an example, you take something like a Linux kernel, and you always hear thousands of eyes, you know, thousands of pairs of eyes, you know, looking at the Linux kernel. When we scan that, we find typically somewhere around 1 to 1.5 actionable defects per 1,000 lines of code. That's today in the kernels that are out there. You can even take some software organizations that are well known for high quality software and still find defects that are actionable. There was a case recently where we scanned the publicly available source for Android as used in the HTC Droid Incredible, found many weaknesses and vulnerabilities and defects in it, published our findings, and got noticed by Google. And since then, we've kissed and made up. And what Google was angry about was not that we published our findings, was that we had used an older release, like the one we could find. You know, so the way we became friends is they gave us 3 newer releases to look at, one of which was hadn't been published yet. And we also agreed that the Coverity guys would take the first step at triage, which is, you know, assessment of the of that release. It has, you know, is this defect real? Is it high, medium, low impact, or something like that? So we took the first whack at that, and now Google's a customer. So it was a rough first date, you know, as it were. So also with open source, there's only 2 ways of getting issues resolved. I have a problem. Well, what do? I get on the net and say, I've got a problem. Anybody got a fix? And you wait. Or you dedicate your own resources into fixing that. Okay? So I've had several cases where I've gone to companies and they've had open source components in really important stuff like weapons systems, in things that control physical things where failure causes damage or can hurt people or kill people. And I talked to the developer and I said, well, you've got a defect over there. He says, not my code, that's in boost. You know, or one of my favorites also is, not my code, that's in the Microsoft Standard Template Library. I said, well, you know, your company's name or your development organization's name is what's on that product. It's going to say it came from, let's pretend we're Roadrunners, Acme Software. It doesn't say Acme plus Microsoft, right? You are responsible for the end product of what your user experience is, or how reliable your software is, or what happens when your software uses, or the environment changes. So your other choice is you've got to know what it is and then provide the resources to maintain that open source, and then you have to be a good citizen. You took it when you downloaded it and incorporated it. You agreed to the open source license, whatever it is. There are several different ones. But as a user of open source, you are obligated to put your fixes back into the community. Maybe not your adaptations, but certainly your fixes. All right? So the value proposition that we have for static analysis is that the earlier we detect a problem, no matter where it is, anywhere within all of the software body that we are using, the open source components, as well as the added value or the applications which we write that sit on top of open source or incorporate open source at the same level. Are we on top of an operating system that's open source, like, let's say, Linux? Am I using libraries, math libraries, comm libraries, communications, displays, time? Am I using things maybe like DDS or CORBA, middleware? Or are they open source applications that are operating at the same architectural level as me? They're all put together. If we have the source, the sooner in the development cycle that we find these defects, the less likely they are to be found in quality assurance or even be in the released product itself. And now NIST has a very interesting curve that's sort of, you know, just a standard exponential that says what is the cost of a defect with relative to the software development lifecycle. The earlier you find it, the cheaper. The later you find it, the cost goes up exponentially. And I kind of think it should be exponential, because it's not only is it hugely expensive when defects are found later in the cycle, but they come at the worst possible time. So if you take here, if you go down into the quality assurance part, what's happening with respect to time? Your developers are trying to stabilize a new release. In the meantime, you've got black box testers saying, this is wrong, that's wrong, this is wrong, that's wrong, making them go back and do rework while they're trying to get the foundational defects out of the system. So you've got developer overload. This is why people have starting to adopt, and I think about 80% of the people I talk with now are adopting some kind of agile or a continuous build with call them sprints, call them scrums or what, where we iteratively produce fully functional releases where each one can be used. And they call them sprints. And every day they have a meeting to decide how we're doing with the sprint, and the only topic of the meeting that I've ever seen is, are we working Saturday this weekend, or are we working Saturday and Sunday? You know, and you're supposed to have a time off between your sprints, and all I've ever seen is the reward that you get for accomplishing a sprint is the chance to do it again on the next one. So the whole idea is that finding these things, the value proposition, is that if we find these defects as early as possible, as soon as they are made, all right, there's reduced risk with respect to quality, budget, and schedule, all of these things. And you can throw any adjective you want in there. The later they happen, those are nouns, sorry. The later that happens, the more expensive it is, and the more risk that we do take. I got this from marketing, so we'll excuse the advertising there. So how the analysis works is there's a number of ways to do it. The one that we do is we watch you build your code. There's a lot of engineering that goes on with creating a build system. Or you use some build system like Electric Cloud or Jenkins, Hudson, or anything like that. Or it could be simple make files. A lot of engineering goes into them, a lot of agony, a lot of blood, and a lot of sweat. So we have a tool that watches your build just to see when do you run your compiler. When you run your compiler, what are the switches, what are the flags, what are the defines, what are the include paths, or with Java, the class paths, or whatever. So we can emulate that precisely. We have a post compiler that can be configured to precisely emulate dozens of compilers. That produces an abstract syntax, which we then read and run the analysis engines over. And then, perhaps the most important part to being productive is the management of those defects, is that we don't want to find things and then keep looking at them every time we build. So if we mark something, this is a huge part of the productivity, where the return on your investment comes, is that if you have something and you say, I did this on purpose, we won't show it to you again. Or something that's endemic to all analysis systems is, we have a certain number of false positives where we ring the alarm bell and we're wrong. You know, we're only machines, all right? And that's also to say that if you mark it that way, well, we won't tell you about it again. So it's not like running lint where you have to, or putting on all the warnings in the compiler, where every time you compile, you're going to get drowned with that stuff. So the signal-to-noise ratio is very important, as well as the visibility. If I have a team and everybody sees that there's a defect, everyone needs to globally be aware that a defect is assigned to one engineer and that others don't need to work on it, because the worst thing that can happen is I have one defect that affects five different people. Let's say it's in a library that's being used by five different applications, and they assign five different people to work on it, and we get five different fixes. That's really a very bad situation, which can be avoided. So by using static analysis and having open source, we can have the source for everything, for the operating system, for the libraries, and for the applications. By having all of that source in just instead of just API contracts, you know, sort of like the declaration of a function in C++, we can actually verify that we are not violating the contract in spirit as well as in the letter of the law. The kind of thing which said that the first argument is a pointer. Static analysis can determine that you could pass a null pointer to this function, which in the argument list would only say pointer. And that would be a bad thing if that function didn't protect itself against a null pointer, but it would be okay if it did. And we can understand things to that level as we go down and analyze the source very much on a interprocedural level, going down the stack as many times as you do. So when you use this stuff and you're a developer and there's a nightly build and it comes back and you said, you've got these defects, fix them, I can have analysis at my desktop and say, did I fix the problem or did I, you know, yes or no, or did I break something else while I fixed it? And the whole idea, again, is to find these things before QA finds them and especially before the product is released. So this is a list of the kind of things that we have found in open source. Part of what we do is we analyze millions and millions of lines of open source. That's how we figure out what needs to be done. And what's interesting here is you see the null pointer dereference, which is usually terminating. The nastiest one, I think, is resource leaks, because it's high impact, because you have to detect that you're doing it, which may take weeks or months, and also is really impossible to readily recreate. Unintentional expressions are usually side effects. The fun you have when you use plus pluses and minus minuses in multiple times in a line. Unintentional expressions can also be from asserts. You know, like sometimes asserts in a debug mode are one thing, but in non-debug mode they don't do anything. Those can trip you up. Uninitialized data, use after free, buffer overflows, all of these things can happen. And that's just the distribution of them that we've seen in the millions of lines of open source that we build all the time. So, as I said, open source is ubiquitous. It's everywhere. And DHS, our Department of Homeland Security, has recognized that. So what they have done is they've worked with us, and we have a thing called scan.coverity.com, where we scan open source projects every night. And right now, We've got 291 projects that we scan every night, and it's 14.5 billion lines of code. And if you go to scan.coverity.com, all the projects are listed there, and what you get is a defect density, defects per K-lock. If you are a developer and register with us as a developer, we'll let you see the actual defects, and then you can fix the code. Now, we're talking about putting the actual defects in the public domain, but you know, you have to talk with the developers. Maybe that will be done on a project-by-project basis. But the important point is 15,278 defects fixed in that open source software. DHS did it to harden that the open source upon which many systems and computer applications are built today that are starting to do things like control the nation's infrastructure. Things like the supervisory control and data acquisition systems that control our pipelines and power grids, all right, or water, sewer, all of those things are more commonly built upon open source now. Matter of fact, a lot of the specifications will either show a requirement or a preference for open source, and that also is coming down within DoD. So, for resources, here's the scan.coverity.com. There's a couple of the one here. This one shows there's got an appendix where we actually show the errors that we found in Android broken down by component, and it shows exactly what you would think. Well, first of all, Google did very well. Remember, I said 1 to 1.5 defects per K-lock. You know, Google had like 1/2 per K-lock, so those guys were pretty good. But what's interesting is if you look at this Android report, is that the older standard parts of Linux are relatively defect-free. It's the newer stuff that's got the defects. What else would you expect? But it's nice to get that confirmation. I'm also got just about a minute left. So I put here a whole bunch of static analysis examples of the kinds of things that we can find. This presentation will be in the proceedings. So all of the lists here of all of the kind of defects that we can find in C and C++ are there, as well as examples of how you can create a memory leak, and the examples of how we find it and report it. And it's done for a number of different situations and a couple of other examples as well. And about that. I guess there's time for a question or so, if any.
I'm Brock Kohlmeyer, and I'm with Wind River Systems. And this afternoon, we're going to speak briefly about our CIMICS. It's a virtual platform for simulating hardware. Roy Patchen will be speaking about that. I'm local here in Howard County. Roy's in from Chicago. I also have George Varndell here, who's a senior engineering specialist focusing on CIMICS. And I first just wanted to say thanks very much, Andrew, I think he left, for having us here. It's a real honor. There he is. These presentations have been great, and we're really humbled to be a part of this. So I just wanted to spend a minute or two front end here to go through the agenda real quick and then just talk about some new developments within VxWorks and Wind River. So again, the format will be I'll be here no more than 5 minutes. I got two slides. I'm only going to talk to one. I'll turn it over to Roy. He'll spend about 20 minutes, speaking about CIMICS. And the last 5 minutes, we'll try to save for some Q&A. If there is anyone afterwards, there's a break at 3 o'clock. I think it's only a 15-minute break. But, the three of us will be here. George can answer any additional questions you might have. I'll be holding up my iPad. It'll have Wind River CIMICS on it out in the lobby. So if you can find us in the corner, we'll try to find some place that's relatively out of the way but has enough room that we can talk. So Again, the first slide, I just wanted to kind of outline a little bit about who Wind River is. I do know quite a few of you. Some of you I don't know. We have a few, four or five different verticals. I'm focused here locally on the aerospace and defense, so both space and airborne and handheld radios and things like that for the defense industry, as well as commercial. But a couple things I wanted to note here, and this is a busy chart, not as busy as the next one, which I won't talk to, but this first one, I just wanted to point out a few areas where we're investing. I mean, we know with all these projects, it's a lot of collaboration between you, the customers, and us, the vendor. Great thing about Wind River, we have a lot of technical people out here locally in the field, like George. George has a counterpart that I work with, Darren Cathy. He's homesick. Hi, Darren. I'm sure he's listening. But Darren and I are here locally supporting APL and Goddard and Orbital and ATK and places like that. But some of the products I'd like to just point out quickly are our hypervisor. We have that capability now with on one processor to actually host, be it Linux, be it VxWorks, all in the same processor. Can be of value with space, weight, and power. That technology has led to more security separation kernel that we haven't seen in space yet. We've heard people talk about it for some DARPA programs, but it's a separation kernel for different levels of security. So you might have a partition, we would call it, handling data at top secret, another at unclassed, all in the same processor. Somewhere in between is our 653 operating system, which is a time and space operating system separation, all on one processor, mainly for safety, came out of our avionics. That we're seeing in some next generation, some successors to the shuttle replacement for getting cargo to the space station, people to the space station. We'll be implementing our 653 OS for safety reasons. So I just wanted to point out those couple things. Rory, again, will be speaking today about CIMIX, which is one of our higher level tools. And with that, thank you again for having us. I'll turn it over to Rory. We'll have some nice handouts later about a couple customers, people like Iridium and GD, which is now part of the division that Orbital Sciences bought that are utilizing CIMIX currently. So.
What's forward, right?
Yes, forward. No,
that's one.
Yeah.
Okay.
Buzz through that.
All right. That was the other slide Rock wasn't going to talk to.
Yeah, I'm not going to talk.
Okay. As being in engineering and development, we go through a number of different aspects of the project to minimize risks. There's risks everywhere. We do IRAD funding to do separation and minimize risks. Gordon talked about risks and open source. Everywhere we look, there's risks. I'm going to kind of summarize some of the typical risk that we see, and specifically risk that we can help minimize in projects today, like hardware availability. You know, we've experienced this for decades. When we're doing real-time embedded systems, it's one thing to be able to go off and do development. It's another thing to be able to do it on the architecture or the target that we're actually trying to develop the low-level software for. That can have a high impact on our ability to meet schedule, to work through challenging items that might be on a brand new project, incorporating new technology. I have multi-core up here as an example, but it could be any kind of new technology that we're trying to incorporate from a hardware perspective. Multi-core happens to be something that a lot of companies are exploring or launching in new products, so that is something that is in the forefront of a lot of different teams' minds. Architectural defects that can be found during integration, that's a huge risk. If you're doing integration and you're finding something architecturally, that's like really late in the project and induces a brand new scheduling risk and potentially success risk with the project ultimately getting launch properly. Multiple companies. This is one that sometimes you don't think of. Multiple companies working on the same project, or multiple divisions that might be located in geographically dispersed locations, that can add a significant risk to a project for anything that's an embedded system. Not being able to utilize or have access to or get scheduled into the actual physical hardware when you're trying to do integration and or debugging. You really need to have access to it, and usually, especially with the group here, the hardware is fairly expensive. We talked about a lot earlier, some of the stories were trying to minimize the cost of that hardware to get it on everybody's desktop. You know, that's another way to do it, but it might not be the actual hardware that's going into the ultimate product. If we take a look at where those risks occur, if we look at a very typical product life cycle, Gordon talked about Agile here a little bit, but a more typical life cycle that everybody's familiar with is system definition, platform, you know, customization, stabilization, and so on. Risk can occur in any of these aspects, any of these parts of your process. System definition, you know, is the architecture that we're depending on actually adequate for the project at the system definition level? And incorporating, of course, the new or unproven or, you know, we don't have experience in kinds of technological advances that we're trying to incorporate. And collaboration amongst the team. A lot of things flow really, really fast in a project. And if we're not collaborating as a tightly coherent team, that can cause problems. In the board bring-up area, that can be delayed greatly due to hardware availability. Or if it's hardware that you're developing, it could be that you've been given something fairly early to get it there, because they have a schedule too, and it's got some flakiness to it. So those types of things. Bringing up the kernel, limited quantity of hardware, all of that typically happens when you're doing your platform stabilization or customization if it's a new platform. And then, of course, during application development, you know, limited hardware availability is a big one there. System integration and test, when you finally get the hardware, you're already sometimes a little bit late in the project, and now you've got to not only schedule time on that hardware, you got to do what's kind of known as the Big Bang approach for integrating, because you got the hardware, so now you're doing everything at once. That's a real hassle sometimes, oftentimes. And then, of course, once it's actually deployed, well, I don't know how many people know about risks that they've uncovered or pre-planned options that they're trying to incorporate into a launch deployed program. And of course, hardware is no longer accessible, at least not the hardware that's launched that I'm trying to do work on. And oftentimes, these platforms get launched for many, many years, if not many decades. And give lots of examples where they're launched for decades. So why not full system simulation? You know, simulation in a lot of different aspects has been around for a lot of years, for a lot of different industries, in fact. So why not for software development when it's on actual system, you know, it's hardware, it's embedded system. So why not simulation for that type of an environment? So just a quick show of hands, has anybody ever heard of Simix other than Rock talking about it? Holy smokes, actually quite a few. Outstanding. Simix is actually a full system simulator for typically large and complex systems. It takes any target, your target hardware and the binaries that run on it, and basically brings it into your development environment, your desktop or notebook. And it could simulate any size target that you have, and it runs the target binaries that you're developing or that you've been given by a subcontractor that they developed and you're incorporating and using, brings all of that and actually runs it unmodified on your host. on the virtual platform that is your ultimate target. It really, really is allowing companies from a lot of different industries. As Rock mentioned, I focus only on aerospace and defense, but a lot of industries are actually getting a ton of value out of CIMIX because it really is allowing them to break the rules on how they do their embedded complex systems development. Lots of different applications. So let me just explain that again. I like this little slide here. I could take my target software. It doesn't matter what OS you're running. Of course, we prefer if it's VxWorks or a derivative of that, but we really don't care because we're taking the binary. So it works with all kinds of different OS, including your own proprietary OS and your middleware and any application code that somebody gave to you that you've linked into your application. And it takes your target, however complex your target is, however dispersed your software is on the different hosts for your target, and brings that into your desktop or notebook and allows you to boot it up just like you would when you hit the power switch on your board. So CIMIX models, you know, complex systems, it can simulate multiple network boards. It can simulate a mixture of architectures that may involve multiple different types of OSs. Maybe it's, you know, bare metal. Different types of processors themselves. It could be single core, multi-core. It controls all boards as a single entity and allows you to do debugging on that single entity. So if I have a system as a whole, which is ultimately where you'd like to try to get to, if I have a system as a whole, what that means is that if I hit a breakpoint, the whole system stops. I have full control over that. So if I'm doing a complete launched system that's up in space right now, I can hit stop and everything stops. So I can examine what's going on. So the ability to manage complexity within CIMIX is virtually unlimited. So I can do multiple boards, hundreds of boards. We've got one situation where there's a constellation of 64 satellites running on a set of boards on the ground. And CIMIX is managing all of that. It happens to be using a different kind of an OS. Application code came from many, many different sources, all brought together, and it's up and running. And they're using it actually for training. It's a training simulator. But the flexibility and configurability of how you manage your system within CIMIX, you have a lot of control over. So it really is complete system simulation. Where people start, if you're doing development for the first time, you might start with just a processor and some memory and get started. We have virtual platforms for most systems that are out there today. The one thing with CIMIX is, if you remember that product lifecycle, systems, definition, and so on, all the way deploy, maintain, CIMIX gets brought into organizations at all different levels within that system development lifecycle. It might be at the very beginning, but it also might be at the very end. I've got an example of a engine manufacturer that happens to go on aircraft. And that engine manufacturer is using CIMIX on a lot of brand new development, but the reason they brought CIMIX in was for the old stuff that they have to maintain another couple decades that's already been deployed for a couple decades. What they're finding is that the solution that they used to have in place, they can't get parts for anymore. So they have to have some other means to maintain a deployed system. Really, really fascinating use cases. But all the way up, system on a chip, very complex. CIMIX manages a system on a chip to complete boards, to a rack of boards, to a complete network of racks or constellation or whatever your system actually is that's deployed. things that are important in that, obviously, are the more you're simulating, the greater value you're going to get out of it. If I'm just doing processor and memory, I'm going to get some value. I'm going to get a lot of value. But the greater value comes from the system as a whole, which might be your RAD 750 card with, you know, space wire and so on. So Simics reduces the product risk here throughout your development life cycle, actually enabling a different change or a change in how you actually do development or additional capabilities to already launched programs. It actually allows you that change. So at the systems definition level, you can begin to start using real target software with the actual hardware, with the actual virtual hardware. With the platform customization part of the product lifecycle, you can eliminate ability or the inability of hardware and make it available for everybody that's doing development or testing or training or architecturally trying to decide what's going on in a flawless system. Application development, utilize the actual virtual target instead of the host development to do your upfront development. So you can start doing more iterative development on that. And for the system integration and test, really eliminate the system availability issue. Almost every shop has a lab with the system in it and a lot of people trying to get at that system. Not all of them software or system developers either. It could be electrical engineers trying to get at the system because there's a whole lot of stuff they have to do. And you can't work together in that lab with that one single expensive system. This allows you to do a lot of integration and test. If you don't do it early on up here, you could do it down here virtually as well with Simics and get a lot of it done. And I'll show some examples of what some customers have said that just this aspect of it allowed them to do. And then, of course, deploy and maintain. And I mentioned an aircraft manufacturer, you know, out 20 years, and they're thinking another 20 years that they have to maintain these engines that are deployed. And the engines are used for a lot of applications. So virtual platforms allowing for collaboration, enabling the collaboration by evolving the prototype that you have through development platform and deploying it actually a deployed customer configuration. So that whole evolution, Simics is used to allow for the collaboration between those designing the hardware and those writing the code for it. Checkpoints allow for collaboration as well. A checkpoint is simply the ability in your system, whether you're doing testing or development or exploring other architectures for an already launched system, you're exploring, you know, the next capability that you're going to provide. What checkpoints allow you to do is take the system and all its state and hardware and the target that's on it and actually take a snapshot and send it to somebody and have them take a look at the system at that point forward. So that's the power that that kind of collaboration brings. Execution data, lots of different access points within Simics. There's virtually nothing you can't get access to. And we provide a lot of reporting right out of the box for that, along with scripts to actually automate maybe regression testing that you have. I got the signal we're running close on time, so I'm going to pick up the pace just a little bit. But these are some of the abilities for you to actually reduce risk associated with debugging and testing. So on the phone, you can't see this, but it'll be recorded. And I guess all of them are very, very important, but you can also connect to your virtual world to the real world. So if there's you get to a certain point, you want input data, that provides a mechanism for you to actually integrate in with something that provides that input data to stimulate your system. Some examples real quick. This is a manned space vehicle. They found value in the development side as well as test and integration. Very large software stack from multiple inputs from multiple vendors. Lots of legacy code in there as well. Hopefully no open source, I don't know. The need to test and integrate that before the hardware was even available, because they had a really, really aggressive schedule. There was no choice. They had to find a way. Development spread across many different development sites, geographically dispersed. Again, really, really difficult situation when you're doing embedded systems. An insufficient number of labs, you know, due to, I don't know if anybody's ever felt budget constraints, due to budget constraints. That's another huge reason why CIMICS is so important. Without CIMICS, they did the waterfall development approach. Integration, you know, occurred for a very long time, lots of bugs in the system. And with CIMICS, they were able to create the virtual target that they were able to disseminate to all their team members. The virtual target was available years ahead of the actual hardware that they would have probably had one lab set up for anyway, and allows system and integration and testing to start years ahead. And it saved them lots and lots of time. They were able to improve a 30-year-old process paradigm by being able to develop things much, much more efficiently in a much more collaborative way. Another unmanned space vehicle, they needed to train operators. So here's where it was already deployed, but they've got to go on a training mission now, and they need another system to be able to train. So they created a host-based version of the target, but again, it wasn't the actual code. It was hosted. It wasn't the actual system that was launched. With CIMICS, they were able to create the virtual program of the satellite hardware and actually run the exact same target software on that virtual platform, and they were able to connect to that to other hardware to create the input stimulus that the system needed so they get real output from it. It reduced a lot of errors when the operators controlled the satellite, as well as the cost of training platforms. That's another big expense that sometimes eats a program alive. Another space vehicle program needed to maintain some aging systems that were launched. And you know, they had a bad upgrade that could actually make the satellite inoperative, and we don't want that to happen. A lot of good stories here on how to help maintain or manage that in software. Hardware failures are they fail in very unpredictable ways, and it can be real harsh to the environment. With CIMICS, they were able to create the virtual platform of each and every satellite out there, and then they were able to change the virtual platform of each satellite as it degraded over time. So they had an actual system, a virtual system of what was in space. And that allowed them to reduce risks of errors when they were actually uploading software, because they could go through and do the test on each and every unique satellite in the constellation with the new software that they intended to put in space. And it kept all the satellites running longer. Some concluding remarks here from observations. Some of these hopefully ring true to you as well. There's a lot of risk, and we're very risk adverse. We need to try our best to minimize risk in the types of programs that we work on. There's a lot of programs in industry that, you know, risk is acceptable. They can ship a product with some risk. Our products, we can't do that, so we're very risk adverse. This risk adversity has created very rigid processes that we have to follow, and that leads to a lot of unnatural things like cost overrun and missed schedules and so on. Full system simulation can help you address these risks by reducing the cost and allowing you to meet schedule and allowing you to predict how things are going to happen as you maintain and deploy systems. What some of the customers are saying, this is a real quick snapshot here. We can't give customer names, but you can see some of these are pretty substantial. In the integration and test side, where it would take them 22 weeks, they were able to knock it down to 29 days. You know, a lot of that is because they had the virtual platform available to them and worked through a lot of the issues up front before the hardware was available. So of course it saved them a lot of time. Finding and solving problems much faster as they're going through development. Preventing loss. This happens to be a very specialized ASIC design. Before it went out to fab, they found errors by using Simix. Setting up labs with the checkpointing capability, you can set them up in minutes rather than weeks. And of course, target hardware, training systems and so forth, you could save lots and lots of money. So Simix again, a lot of people understand or have heard of Simix before. This was really, really fast walkthrough of Simix. I apologize, there's only so much time we've got. As Rock said, we will, George and Rock and I will be available the rest of today. I think George is hoping to be here tomorrow as well. But we've got our cards and a couple brochures. Feel free to holler if there's anything we can do to help you as well. I think we got just a couple minutes here for some questions. Yes? And I went through that really, really fast. I'll slow down when I come and talk to you.
One of the things that we picked on everybody else that talked about test beds was the performance in terms of X times faster than real time, things like that. Can you comment on how Simix does in some of these environments to create faster than real time?
I can give you anecdotal evidence. There's no one answer to that. It depends on the workload. These young men here run actual flight code from a project that I won't name. They might name it to you if you ask them. And it runs at approximately 3.5 to 4 times real time. It can be slowed down to real time, and sometimes that's necessary. Simix has a real time only mode. If you're running, say, a Red 750 with an application that is on real hardware, it would only be consuming 30% of the CPU. You might see 7-8 times real time. It's variable because basically the host is doing the best it can to execute instructions as rapidly as they can.
Any other questions?
Just a quick one. It can benefit from multi-core hosts then, so you can get a quad-core or an 8-core machine?
Absolutely. As long as your system model can be multi-threaded, and you have this is a technical thing I can't get into because it would take too long.
Yeah, so you have to expend a little bit of energy to make it compatible with a multi-core environment?
Yeah, a single CPU with devices where everything's tightly coupled, the timing that Simix has to impose on everything that happens there has to happen in one thread. Two boards communicating over Ethernet or SpaceWire, they can be in multiple threads. Four boards can use all four cores on a Core i7.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Joel Sherrill. I'm the project lead for RTIMS, real-time project. And before I get started, I don't usually get to do this. I'm one of the original team that developed RTIMS. Outside is Mark Johannes, who was also one of the original team members. Chris Johns came all the way from Sydney. He's over here in the fleece and top and jeans. He actually remembers asking me about RTIMS on Usenet in about 1992, and he's been around from pretty much the very beginning. And then the next generation over here is Gadair. You can wave. There's Gadair. He came to us thanks to the Google Summer of Code last year. You were my student, right? Am I not blanking out wrong? And this year he actually mentored someone. And so we're rare to have that many core developers in one place. So we're going to go over what has been happening to RTIMS lately, not as much of that as what has happened since the 4.10 release branch was happening, what is upcoming, and what we'd really like to see happen. Because RTIMS is really driven by your requirements. I mean, we listen to the space domain a lot. We also listen to the experimental physics. We've got a number of commercial users, but you guys have really stringent requirements. And if we follow the practices and requirements of this domain, we make everyone very happy. So what I want to also emphasize is that we have a very community-driven focus, that we want everybody to think of us as an extension of you. The only requirements we really have are to make your project successful. So if there's something wrong, a missing feature, just ask. If somebody's got a good idea, we're happy to listen. That's why things have happened. And we'll go over each of these as we go forward. The first thing is that RTEMS only exists today. I mean, it's been around over 20 years. The only reason it's still here is because there are users. If there were no users and no one was interested, it would have died a long, long time ago. So people are interested. You're all using it. I have learned about more projects that I didn't even know about, and I was at Johnson last month and realized that I rattled off about 20 projects. About 10 of them were not. Oh. So that I that were not listed on the website. So just remember that your requirements are what drive us to do things, to change things, to improve things. Someone here mentioned that they think they found a README that was wrong. Well, that's the only way it gets fixed, is just to ask. Most of the improvements are either funded by users or suggested by users, and some volunteer takes it on. And clearly, most bug reports are from users, because if there weren't users using it, they wouldn't use it in ways that pushed the edge conditions and broke things. But there really aren't that many bugs. Most of the bugs, as was mentioned earlier, are in new code. And I should mention, we're also a member of the Coverity Scan program, and I did provide input for the annual report, but Android was a lot more interesting than what I had to say. We only had one bug, one real bug to fix from the Coverity Scan, so we weren't really interesting. And it wasn't easy to identify the case that even got there. Nobody had ever hit it. Wrong button. The first thing I want to mention is we really make an effort to try to pull in the next generation of developers, to involve universities and students. We have mentored a large number of students in and outside of formal programs. We have been in the Google Summer of Code for 4 years. We have mentored 30 students. As part of that, Google sponsors about 1,100 students a year to work on open source projects. It was $4,500 last year, now it's $5,000 for them for the year. We've had some great work done. This has done two things for us. It promotes RTEMS for use in research projects and gets students. It also forces us to be very, very approachable, because you guys know what embedded systems are, you know what cross development is, you know how painful some of these things always are. This is all new and foreign, so we have had to tailor all of our getting started. We've tried to tailor it to college students. We actually have participated in the Google High School program last year, and we had to tailor that down. So the Summer of Code, this is 4 years. Chris, Gadare, and I are leaving tomorrow to go actually to the Mentor Summit, where we interact with other projects. The code-in is really interesting. It's high school students, so you have to really put, the tasks are just a few days, so we have to really make them very clear. I'm really proud to say that this logo right here, the first new logo we've had in years, high school student did it. Really just blew me away when we first got it. Looks really nice. It was done by a high school student who's now at Caltech. There were only 20 open source projects involved in this. Google has, on the Summer of Code, has never had more than 175. So that puts us in the upper tier of open source projects. It's like a good housekeeping seal of approval. They watch your community and make sure you're friendly and things like that. We have a student from the ESA Summer of Code and Space that I'm mentoring. He is doing some improvements to the coverage, so we can output our coverage format to feed the GNU coverage tools and possibly the GNU performance analysis. But one of the things that Chris and I have pained greatly over is we've realized that we're a 20-plus-year-old project, and we don't know how that, we know how that translates into dog years, but we do not know how that translates into computer years. But we do realize that we are at 20 years, where things get long in your tooth, and some things come and go. We've replaced the website 3 times over the life of the project. We have we've also had to transition wikis twice, bug tracking systems. Things die, things fall out of favor, better tools come along. And if we don't continually improve our own processes, we'll just slowly age, and I don't want to turn into a Fortran 4 project. So we just have to continue evolving, or we're not going to attract new developers, and it'll and our 20-year-old tools will be your 50-year-old tools when your projects are old. So, you know, we have to start, we think about those things, and we're trying to have a formal mechanism for dealing with it. One of the things that's happened recently, a volunteer from the Network Time Protocol has set up a build bot for RTIMS. So every time a change is checked in, it will build every configuration and test it. But that also forced us to realize that CVS is very aged and doesn't have many capabilities. So we're in the process of transitioning to Git. The first rule was to get atomic change sets. That's the thing that pushed us over the edge. You need an atomic change set to fill into the build bot to get blame. So we're trying to improve our processes and move along. What the side effect is, this is we really just want a formal process, a list of questions to ask, to go self-examination. Yeah, we picked that 10 years ago, but would we have picked it today? I mean, you get used to using things and you just don't realize it's time to throw them away and do it again. And that's what we're trying to do. I mean, how many version control systems have there been in the past 15 years? And they each have advantages and disadvantages, but the general model has evolved. And we have learned, unfortunately, that if you don't plan for these transitions, you can wait too late and the transition can be painful. And we really do not want that to happen again. Chris, I think, got to modify the conversion scripts to go from GNATS to Bugzilla, and that was painful. We were one version too late to do the transition. So what our goal is to just make sure that our transitions are planned, not forced, and that we can evaluate when we want to transition. So one of the things we're discussing is there are patch review systems where people can individually comment on lines of a patch. And you have to have, like, say, two developers sign off on a patch before it's committed. And that's not something that existed really 10 years ago. So that's something we would like to get incorporated into our processes. But we're really trying to have the right infrastructure to provide a high-quality real-time operating system. And our job is not to support tools that have fallen out of favor. So we're better off following the sweet spot of the tools. So as a project, that's one of the things we've come to realize. I don't know whether we're, what, three computing generations old or seven. I mean, the ERC32 is about the same age as RTIMS, so, you know, we're not that old in space hardware terms, but we're that old in software terms. The project itself maintains two active branches. Right now, that's 4.9 and 4.10. In the past year, well, in calendar year 2011, there have been two new releases on the 4.9, which is accounts for about 30 formal problem reports. Some of those are documentation errors, minor things. The 4.10 release was cut, and one of the things, since Alan's here, I'll mention that he does. When we try to cut release branches, those are not feature-driven. Those are customer-driven and quality-driven. We waited until we knew MMS wanted to fly 4.10, so we waited until MMS and a couple of other projects and our own internal testing were all happy with it. So it's important for us to get feedback from our customers. 4.10.1 was a typical .1 release. People don't test until you cut a release, so there's always new BSPs, and a lot of BSPs get fixed. The .1s and the .2s are always full of BSP changes, and that's pretty much the whole 30 PRs. One of the cool things is that there is now a RAD 750 BSP. I'll just say ITARS, talk to us offline, and because it cannot be merged. This is the first BSP we've ever wanted that actually we cannot distribute publicly. So if you're interested in that, it's now should be available, so we'll deal with that offline. Since 4.10, there have been quite a few changes. I should have mentioned one of the big things in 4.10, one of the big new features of the RTIMS file system that Chris developed for MMS. That's a very big feature that happened in 4.10. 4.11 has had some really big features. Goddard last summer implemented a pluggable scheduler infrastructure, which I had dreamed about for a long time. It allows us to, instead of having only a priority-based preemptive scheduler, we now have application configure time schedulers you can choose. The deterministic priority scheduler is the one we've always had. There is what we call a simple priority scheduler, which is very appropriate for low memory, simple systems like 16-bit processors with a low number of tasks. It's a very low resource. Goddard mentored a student who put in the second generation earliest deadline first, because yours, you didn't like it enough to merge it, and the constant bandwidth. I did it again, didn't I? Okay. It's not constant block, it's constant bandwidth. I have to be retrained. But we also have an RTEM scheduler simulator to allow you to write scripts that allow you to push the scheduler simulator. I wanted the pluggable scheduler infrastructure for two primary reasons. The first is what's on the bottom of the page. We needed a symmetric multiprocessor aware scheduler as an alternative to the single core scheduler. So the scheduler interface is pluggable. You can now have that allowed us to have an SMP scheduler. The other thing it allows you to do is have these advanced schedulers, the earliest deadline first and the CBS scheduler, and any other research scheduler that comes along that looks like it's appropriate for your application. The symmetric multiprocessing support is new in 4.11. Most of the work on that was, in fact, sponsored by someone in the space community. It has been tested on Leon 3 and PC386. It's been tested up to four cores on Leon 3 and up to, the formal testing was on four, but I think I actually ran some tests on a 32-core configuration. There is plenty of room for improvement. This is the first version of it, and I'm sure there will be many more improvements. Geissler Aeroflex has actually been running it and checking it out on real hardware the past couple of weeks, so it is running on real hardware now. One of the other changes is 64-bit time. RTEM's now internally, it's had the support for a while, but now we can keep internal time in nanoseconds since the POSIX epoch, which will allow us not to overflow internally for another 580 years. And if it's broken, then I'll fix it for free. So the nice thing about this is the thing that finally tripped it over to be the one of the preferred ways of doing time was someone asked on the mailing list and said, I'm deploying a product with a 30-year lifespan. I need the time to work. And it's like, okay, I already had it there. It's time to make it the default. We finally have Cortex M3 support, which was a big thing we wanted. And again, to point out Gadare, he added the Spark 64. I don't think the user base is not so large, is it? No. But you've got your Ultra Sparks and you're happy. So, and Chris and a couple other people have worked on improving the Altera NIOS support. And this is coming along, and it worked fine. It just had more maturity. There's a number of new BSPs. Obviously, with a new port comes a new BSP. There's been a lot of work in the PowerPC. The bottom two QEMU, those will actually are close to simulating the old Motorola computer group, the classic VME boards that we all got from them and now Emerson. So those are equivalent to those, the same board support package running on a simulator. It's nice to see Q or IQ support now. So what else would we like to see? There's some things we can't schedule. The things we don't schedule are board support packages, bugs, those just happen. And the other things we look for and we just beg for. We go, it's an open source project. If you really want it, it'll happen. So here are the things that are on the list. And I've talked about coverage the past 2 years, so I'm not going to say a whole lot except what's changed. The important thing is that we do instruction and now branch level coverage at the instruction assembly level for 10 board support packages covering 6 architectures, and the coverage hovers near 100% for the core of the operating system proper for instruction coverage. These reports are published on the web. We're happy to do it. It keeps us all honest. When people merge code, Gadare can tell you we'll come right back and ask for test code because if you make it worse, you're going to fix it. You'll either rework the code to get the path out or we'll find a way to test it. So the initial focus was what I call the RTEMS proper, the OS, the SuperCore, the classic API, the POSIX API, and basically initialization and the IO manager and a couple others. The initial focus was on instruction coverage only. We've since moved on thanks to some help. We've added branch taken, not taken coverage, and that's hovering for the core of RTEMS in the 97 to 98% range. So of all the branches, when you say there's like 10, I don't know how many it is off the top of my head, 10,000 branches, that's 20,000 taken, not taken. We have test cases that will do between 96 and 98% of those, depending on day of the week and the processor. Thanks to a Google Summer Code Project last summer, we are now have expanded the testing out to include a large part of the C library support. and file systems for the coverage to come along on that. The reports are now included in the release, so you can check what the coverage is, and it's just kind of a continually improving thing. A Google Code In student actually put the code in to show time graphs of how the coverage is going over time. The wish list, an ESA Summer of Code student is working on the output of the CovOAR tool into GCOV format, so we can use that to generate standard GNU coverage formats. There are also other tools that read that. He has modified CovOAR to include to gather the performance data from the trace runs. If he gets time, we'll start producing GPerf output. The thing about this is you can actually run this tool on any output of anything that can give you trace information and get your own coverage reports on any program. What we really want is help from domain experts, and you know, you guys are those, and or you know them. We would really like to know how our coverage maps onto DC and MCDC, and we really want to produce reports that are not just in an arbitrary format, but are actually meaningful and useful to you. Because we'll just pick something that helps us test. That's the important thing to us. You need them to validate and to pass flight qualification tests. And if you have students, interns, there's always a list of things that you can submit test cases for, and we're happy to take those. But coverage is an enormously long journey with lots and lots of small steps. Those last cases are, you know, it takes whole tests just to hit the small cases at the end. And coverage is going to be a continuous battle, and I'm really proud that we've taken it on and that we're doing so well with it. The capture engine is a trace engine for our TIMS. Chris has worked on it with two summer code students, I think, and it's at a point where it needs some feedback and some user support to help finish it. It can now generate all the trace wrappers, compile link, download, capture the trace. I think he has filter support. You generate a trace stream, which can be gotten off board and displayed in ASCII, and we're looking at tools to display it as a graphical support. But this needs real feedback from real projects and support to figure out what you guys really like. So that's the important thing to get. The runtime loader is also something Chris has worked on. He's happy to talk to anybody about it. It is a runtime loader to do dynamic loading for RTIMS. There has been something called CEXP, which did this, which was heavy on the target side. This is intended to be extremely light on the target side to put all the work possible up front to avoid memory fragmentation. And it was developed for MMS. It is in targeting a fairly low-end processor, not a RAD 750 in resources. It's intended to go on the smallest type of embedded space processors that you'll see. So remember, RTIMS is really a single process. So what we're mostly talking about here is loading pieces of your application and making it easier to upgrade. So you can load libraries, you can load separate objects, and then the link editor will resolve the symbols and load the symbol table. And there's a small amount of architecture-specific code. And so what happens is you create a base image, and then you have to link your smaller objects that are dynamically loaded against that so they know how to get the symbols out of what's already on the target hardware. This is approaching usability, I would say. I mean, it's real, and probably just will need documentation, porting to other architectures, and a few little features. C++ probably will work, but probably hasn't been, I'm guessing hadn't been tested. It only supports a few architectures now, but probably, when we say a few, most of the time that covers a good part of the base, but it's easy to add them. Needs user documentation, and we'd like feedback on how to make it easier to use from the host side. So again, this is in the needing user feedback and support. We want to upgrade the TCP/IP stack, and we have just had discussions with the FreeBSD people on how to do this in the BSD community. So we admit that there turns out every board BSD and a couple of other free operating systems share code out of the BSD kernels. We all swap code, and we actually have had meetings with five or six of the BSDs and a few other open source projects, including Minix, and they have agreed that once we find out what the stable porting layer is for the BSD kernel code, they will make it more formal and more stable and will include us in discussions on modification. The main thing for this is to get the FreeBSD bus space API. which is how the BSD kernel accesses buses and DMA, and to have a version of that for RTEMS so we can port the TCP/IP stack. So this is really a large project that's is going to need user funding to pull together. The other part of this, and Chris and I both are digging in our heels, there is a port of the USB, FreeBSD USB stack to RTEMS. It supports removable disk media now. We refuse to merge it because it does not have the bus space API. So we want it to come in at the same time as the TCP/IP stack, and then we will have a formal porting kit for any BSD code in the future. This will allow us also to pull in a SATA driver and other things like that. This code is available in Bugzilla. It's just got that one spot we're holding back on. And I think this is actually in a fielded customer system at the moment. There's something I've worked on the past couple of years. It doesn't look like much, but it's a formal API and interface for putting in multi-IO boards that are real common. The ones I've done are PC-104 based, discrete in, discrete out, analog in, analog out, trying to make it easier to go. Again, feedback from users. So what does OAR do? Number one, we try desperately hard to act as a park ranger, a custodian, a steward for RTEMS, but we also have consult on RTEMS, and we host the entire project. So what do? The community supports 4.11, 4.9, and 4.10. We also offer support so you can get guaranteed bug fixes and questions quicker. The thing that's really of interest is for most of you is we offer legacy support for older branches that are no longer supported by the free community. We are supporting 4.6. There is a 4.6 release which has 54 fixes not in the last public release. So if you filled a product and you need support, it's still out there. 4.6 is approximately 10 years old at this point, and we're still offering bug fix versions for it. We will do this in true RTEMS spirit. As long as somebody wants it, it will be there. The support subscriptions are for regular support for the current versions, do rapid response, and we'll assist to installing environment. We're going to start putting DVDs and including these in the subscription, so you can install from DVD without having to have net access, and you have a master controlled DVD with full source to hand off to your configuration management people. So that should help out. That's a problem we've seen visiting customer sites. Chris and I have had many discussions on the question of how to get your feature merged. The simple answer is talk to us, involve the core developers. It helps if you keep them involved and pay them to review, because then it will get merged. Otherwise, you're depending on our good graces and how much we want to stay away from our families to review the code. If you help us take the time to do it, it will be much better. Please don't throw us a large body of code over the end and then get your feelings hurt when we don't have time to look at 100,000 lines of code and review it. It may be great, but we're responsible for it long term. Users have funded major improvements. The RTEMS file system, the runtime loader, and symmetric multiprocessing are at the top of the list. Other things like the RAD 750 BSP and any number of other BSPs. But get a core developer involved and help them and support them to take their time getting the feature merged. And that's really the important thing. It's largely a volunteer project. It's completely driven by user needs. We are trying really hard to continually improve our processes internally to involve the next generation of computer scientists. That's a critical thing in our industry. We need engineers to come along who are young, and we want to support projects long term. So just ask me any questions you got now.
Okay, I will.
Uh-oh.
Hi.
Oh, you
Hi,
got
Joel.
A question. Hi.
I do. Actually, this is from Amalai Oyaki, who's back at JPL.
It's probably hard.
Amalai says hi, and he says he's one of the organizers of the workshop. He says, ask Joel, what simulators run on the RAD 750 BSP? He has three questions. Will it run on QEMU, and which BSPs does QEMU run?
Okay, I'll start with the first. Simix is the only thing I know that supports RAD 750.
Okay.
So I'll defer to you. RAD 750 supports that, right?
Okay.
I mean, Simix supports RAD 750, so that's the first answer to that. Okay. So we debugged it on real hardware.
And the BAE SpaceWire ASIC.
Okay.
Okay, does it run on QEMU?
No, but it probably could because they do 750 support, so it's not that unusual except for that. And but it would be the things you care about, you have to violate ITAR to include. So I would say it would probably be unwise.
Okay.
You could run it on a generic 750 BSP. So.
Okay, and the last one is, which BSPs does QEMU run on which?
Okay, there are a number of BSPs, and off the top of my head, there's the normal PC 386, there's a Lattice Micro 32. There are two PowerPC variants. There will soon be a MIPS BSP on QEMU, and there might be another one. There's another ARM. There's an ARM BSP that runs. Gumstick. The Gumstick. One of the Gumstick boards runs on QEMU.
Okay, very.
They support more boards than we have BSPs for. So if he's interested in something in particular, we just need to look at that one. We focused on QEMU. Mostly either because they matched things we had hardware support for or because they filled a testing niche for us. Again, simulators are important to test on. And in our environment, they're critically important because those are the reference boards for our users to test on and for students to use.
Very good.
So Joel, you did mention the support for SMP in 4.11, right? And
yes.
I just wanted to know what is the status and what the plan is.
All code that exists is completely merged. There is no unmerged code, as far as I know, unless there is a bug report in Bugzilla at the moment. It is all there. It works, but we're real conservative, so we're just saying it's early. And it supports the processors probably most people care about, the Spark, Leon 3, and a PC. Probably the PowerPC, some multi-core PowerPC, I'm guessing, would be the next one that's likely to be supported. And there is a large patch for asymmetric multiprocessing if anybody's interested, which supports 16 cores, which is running on 16 cores. So it's pretty mature in that sense. It just needs user time. So we're around, so just ask us questions.
Thank you, Joel.
Thanks.
It's worth noting, Joel and OAR have a booth out here in the hallway. Feel free to contact them.
Okay, I'm Ben Ilbesacker. I'm here from Grammatech, and I'm going to be talking about some new concurrency bug finding tools that we've been working on. First, a really quick profile of the company. Grammatech spun out of Cornell. It was founded by Tim Teitelbaum and Tom Reps, two important figures in the program analysis community. We focus on program analysis and manipulation, both at the source and binary level. Today I'm going to be talking primarily about source analysis. And we have many customers in the aerospace military community. In particular, for anyone from JPL who's listening, I've been told there's a site license there, so you should give it a try. Okay, and like I said, today I'm going to be talking about static analysis of concurrency bugs in particular, two new features that are going to be coming into the next version of our product, one for detecting data races. This was done under a DARPA contract, and another for detecting deadlocks and other misuses of locks. This was done by an important figure in this community, Gerard Holtzman. At JPL in collaboration supporting his software standards efforts. Okay, so first I'm going to do a little bit of motivation about why concurrency is important, and basically that's being driven by new hardware, and then why concurrent programming is hard, and how our new analyses can help you make concurrent programming a little bit easier. So basically, the processor world is moving to multicore. All new personal computers have multicore processors, and even relatively conservative embedded systems will eventually, if they haven't already, be moving towards multicore if there's any need for high performance, because single-threaded performance scaling has just fallen off a cliff due to physics and circuit reasons, and nobody sees that picking up again anytime soon. So multicore is here, and in order to get performance on multicore today, basically you need to do concurrent programming. And concurrent programming is really hard. as a nice little visualization about the extra dimension of difficulty that concurrent programming adds to the normal difficulties of software development. We have this little picture here in the top. We have two threads, the red thread and the blue thread, each of which is only going to do two things. And there are six different ways those two events and the two threads can be interleaved. Now, if we take this teeny tiny example and just make it a teeny tiny bit bigger and say each of those two threads is going to do three things, now there are 20 different ways that those two threads can be interleaved. And in principle, each time you run this software that we've cartoonishly represented here, you could get any of those behaviors. What does this mean? This means that testing just got a heck of a lot harder as soon as you start doing concurrent development, because you don't know which of these behaviors you're going to get on any particular run. So this non-determinism, one of those different behaviors you're going to get is a huge problem. When you have billions of instructions running in each thread instead of two or three, the numbers get really astronomical about the number of different interleavings you can get. And the particular interleaving you get on any particular run is going to depend on real-world events. And of course, real-world events are outside the control of your software. So inevitably, each time you run, you're going to be in a different situation. You might get a different behavior out of your software. Also, if you have a scheduler, that can add an effectively non-deterministic element into the behavior of concurrent software. And of course, the correctness is going to depend on which particular behavior you get. And if you happen to get one in the field that you didn't get when you were testing, you might end up with a nasty crash. So the bugs that I'm going to be talking about today, race conditions and data races, are a major source of differing behavior between those different interleavings, different orders of events in different threads. And if you can eliminate the possibility of data races and deadlocks from your source code entirely, what that means is that the number of interleavings that will display different behaviors can be collapsed way back down. And so you can claw back some of the power of testing by making the different behaviors, but the different interleavings have all the same behavior by eliminating the concurrency bugs at their roots. Okay, so just to make sure we're all on the same page here, the basic textbook definition of a data race is a situation where you have multiple threads that are accessing a single piece of shared data. At least one of those threads writes into that piece of data, and the accesses between the two threads are not separated by some kind of explicit synchronization. So if you have that situation when the software is running, you have a data race, and data races can leave your system in an inconsistent state. It can corrupt the memory. And then once the memory is corrupted, of course, all manner of bad symptoms can occur down the line. And that down the line part is actually really critical. One of the reasons why concurrency bugs can be so pernicious and so hard to get rid of is that, okay, your data race causes a little memory corruption, but that's not going to make your program crash right now. It might not result in a crash or other really strange behavior until that memory corruption has propagated through many more layers of your system. Okay, here is a nice little example, just to have some pictures to look at. So this is an assembly line where we're counting the number of widgets on the assembly line. We have two different sensors that we're going to assume are implemented in different threads that update a single count. And when the widget comes in, we increment the count, and a widget goes out, we decrement the count. And in order to see the nastiness of the data race here, we have to realize that while the increment and decrement aren't really atomic operations, each of those threads has to load in the shared value from whatever memory location it's in, perform the arithmetic on it, and then store it back. And so if you have those two threads interleaved in just the wrong way, where they load it in the same value, perform arithmetic on it, and then try to store back. Now, one of them isn't going to see the update from the other, and you end up with some corrupted junk in the count. And so down the line, your controller's not going to know how many widgets there are, and you have widgets falling off the assembly line or some such badness. So I alluded there to one of the reasons why data races are so hard to debug. In that case that we looked at, the window of opportunity for the data race expressing itself as bad behavior is tiny. Each of these threads is just loading in the value, changing it, and storing it back. That's probably going to take an infinitesimally small amount of time, so you can test it for, you know, machine years and never see two threads happen to hit that particular bit of code at the same time. But when they do, then you get the bad behavior. So that's one of the things that makes data races so hard to debug. Their expression is often very rare. Diagnosis is often very difficult because, as I said a couple slides ago, the actual bad symptom often happens much later after the data race corrupted the memory. And also, diagnosis is hard because developers tend to have a frame of mind of looking at the code and thinking about it in a single-threaded way, because that's how we read code. We say, okay, here's the machine's going to step through these steps. And as you read the code that way, it's easy to convince yourself, oh no, it's just not possible for there to be a data race here. It requires sort of concurrent thinking, which basically nobody is a natural at. So as you, in normal investigative approach to debugging, it's really hard to say, to go backwards from a symptom to an execution that could have resulted in that symptom. Also, reproducibility is a huge problem because the expression of a data race often depends on very finely tuned timing of events in different threads, and depending on what kind of system you're running on, it can be really hard to force a particular timing to happen. Okay, so at Gramatech, we have recently built some data race detection technology from recent research, built it into our industrial strength static analysis tool. And I just want to very, very briefly talk about that tool to give you a context for what the analysis is going to do. So it's a static bug finding tool. This is Code Sonar. And it uses symbolic execution for whole program path-sensitive analysis. So in the limit, you can think of it as basically executing every possible path through your program. Now, for large programs, that's not possible, so it's an approximation. And some of the really critical ways in which it does that approximation in order to scale up to large code bases is that it does a bottom-up analysis in the call graph, and it does summarization of procedures so that procedures don't have to be reanalyzed over and over again. And because it does this interprocedural full path kind of symbolic execution, we get very accurate pointer analysis and feasible path analysis relatively inexpensively. Okay, so that's a really quick introduction to Code Sonar. And now I want to tell you how we go about finding data races at a high level. What we do is use a lockset style approach. What this means is that the analysis is going to try to infer for each piece of shared memory in your program what lock is protecting it. And it does this by, as the symbolic execution executes, it gathers up all the locks that happen to be held when various memory locations are accessed, and then builds up a set of those. We also have to find all of the procedures or methods, if you're using an object-oriented API, that represent the thread entry points. And then at those thread entry points, we sort of gather up all of the memory that might be accessed by that thread and all of the locks that might be held while those memory locations are accessed. And then we do a big comparison. Each pair of threads that might run at the same time, we say, OK, for each memory location, which locks are held by this thread, which locks are held by this thread, do an intersection of those sets. If that intersection is empty, then we found a possible data race, because there's no single lock that's consistently protecting access to that memory location. OK, I don't expect you to read all this text that I've thrown up on the slide. I just want to give you an overall picture of how we present these data race results to the user. So this is a picture of CodeSonar running. And on the left and right are snapshots from two different threads. And these are interprocedural paths through code from some thread entry points. On the left is the actual main of the whole program. On the right is some other thread. What we happen to be looking at here is GNU chess that launches a separate thread to process the input. And then at the bottom, there are accesses to some shared piece of memory. In this case, it's the input status variable. And on the left, we can see that the input mutex lock is held. On the right, the wake up mutex lock is held. Those are, when we intersect those sets, we get nothing. And so in fact, there is a data race here. And it's pretty clear that either one developer or multiple developers was a little confused about which mutex was supposed to be protecting access to this variable. And it turns out to be a relatively easy fix. OK, now I want to do a little bit more motivating, because it's sort of conventional wisdom that when data race warnings are presented to programmers, they often say, yeah, OK, I see what you're saying, but this data race is OK. It doesn't really matter. So I'm showing here one of the prototypical examples of that, taken from a really fabulous paper by Hans Bohm, who's one of the C++ concurrency experts. So this code is the double-checked locking pattern, or the lazy initialization pattern. And the goal here is to initialize some variable, my data. And we only want to initialize it once, but multiple threads might want to read it somewhere down the line. So ignore the top line ignore that top line for a second. In the middle, we just have lock. Doesn't matter which lock we're locking. And then if not initialized, do the initialization, set the initialization flag to true, and then unlock. That's great. That'll work just fine. But then somebody got clever and say, hey, I don't want to pay all this cost for locking and unlocking all the time when most of the time I'm just reading this thing. I'm only going to initialize it once. So I'm going to get clever, and I'm going to check that initialization flag before I enter the critical section that's protected by the locks. This creates a data race, because one thread can be writing to that variable init flag. Some other thread can be reading from it, but it's not holding a lock. So it's a data race. But it's really easy to say to yourself, you know what? But in this code, it's OK. It's never going to create a problem, I'm sure. Well, one of the many ways in which this code can go wrong is if your compiler gets too clever, says, hey, there's no dependence between this thing initializing my data and setting init flag to true. So I'm just going to flip the order of those two statements. Compilers do that kind of thing all the time. So now, the init flag is set to true before the data is actually initialized. So that second thread can come through, see that init flag is true, skip this whole block, and grab this uninitialized my data. Now you've got some wild pointer. Who knows what's going to happen with that down the line? And there are a lot more those kinds of horror stories in this paper. It's a really good motivation for just not allowing data races in your program. They're going to kill you somewhere down the line. OK, I'm just going to briefly mention that the other major class of concurrency bugs that we're now supporting in our next version of CodeSonar is deadlocks. And we're using the classic Dijkstra-Hoare the Dijkstra algorithm, or approach, I should say, where if a program has a global ordering on all of the locks that are used, and in order to grab lock B that is lower or later in the ordering than lock A, you must already be holding lock A. If you enforce that invariant, then your program can never deadlock by one thread holding lock A and wanting lock B, the other thread holding lock B and wanting lock A, if you enforce that global ordering. So using code sonar and its symbolic execution again, we can check to see globally in the whole program which locks are being acquired while some other lock is being held. We build up a large graph of all of those relationships and then just look for cycles in it. And if we find a cycle in that graph, that's evidence that two threads might acquire locks in an inconsistent order, and that might lead to deadlock. I'm not going to talk about these other sort of misuses or bad style uses of locks, but we've added checks for these as well. And to conclude, multi-core processors are inevitable. They are the future of any kind of performance critical computing. And at least as of today, and many people predict in the future as well, if you want to get performance on a multi-core processor, you have to be doing concurrent programming. concurrency errors are really nasty. In some ways, they're much nastier than other classes of single-thread software bugs. Really hard to reproduce, diagnose, and eliminate. And even ones that by really careful hand analysis of the software look benign can actually be quite bad because of strange things that your compiler and your architecture are doing behind your back. And finally, at Grammatech, we're bringing some recent research in static detection of these concurrency bugs to industrial strength bug finding tools. And we hope that you'll give it a try to help eliminate these bugs from your software. Thanks for your attention.
Are there questions?
Yeah, I had a question. I mean, you had mentioned multi-core, but everything you said would apply even to single-core multitasking type applications, right? I mean, there's...
Absolutely, yeah. I just used multi-core as a motivation for why this is becoming even more important these days.
Thanks.
And in fact, it's also the case that on a single-core, often these kinds of bugs can be masked because usually one thread will run for a relatively long period of time, then it gets swapped out and something else runs. So it's quite common for a multi-process, multi-threaded, multi-task application that has been running happily on a single core to then go to multi-core, and all of a sudden concurrency bugs start popping up because you have real parallelism going on, and the number of interleavings that you see just skyrockets.
Very good.
Other questions?
Yeah.
Ed?
So does your tool require the use of locks before it can find concurrency errors, or does it just require the identification of shared data across thread entry points?
So our tool discovers what the shared data is. But it does also require a locking approach. It's the algorithm it uses is based on a concept of critical sections and that you access shared data within critical sections.
Well, so if I use a shared piece of data without using locks whatsoever, then I've got a concurrency issue. Will you find that kind of bug?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I feel like I might have misunderstood your question.
Well, so you're not dependent on having locks used and identifying, taking a lock and then incorrectly releasing it.
Oh, no. If you don't use a lock at all, it will flag that as a potential data race, for sure.
Mm-hmm. Does your tool deal with dynamic control flow, like exceptions, function pointers, and, for example, set jump, long jump type situations?
Let's see. Whatever support kind of base code sonar has for that, the concurrency checks will inherit that. And some of those are supported, and some of them are not, or are partially supported. And I don't know exactly what the level of support for those various mechanisms is well enough to say, to rattle it off right now. But if you want to follow up, I'd be happy to steer you towards the answer to that.
Any other questions? Okay, I'll point out to you, Gramatech does have a booth out here. We can probably answer your question.
Yeah, there. And more? Curtis is here, yeah. Also from Gramatech.
For the person who had that last
here,
question.
Here.
Thanks so much. For the person who had that last question, I think it's probably best taken offline. We can talk about the specific program structures. So Ben was trying to be as accurate as he possibly could. And by the way, he's very accurate. He's the one who developed this. And I'm just the guy who sells it. But we can talk about that specific control flow later on. Sound good? Thanks so much, Alan. Appreciate it.
Good afternoon. My name is Douglas Foreman. I'll be telling you a little bit about the Laddie flight FSW talks that got into more detail on the model-based development and how CFE was used, as well as some of the VNV, model-based VNV, but you can look back to earlier years for those. So today I'm gonna be talking about how the POSIX IO driver approach has played into the Laddie rapid development methodology. So a little background. Laddie evolved from earlier Ames research involving modular spacecraft. The HTV successfully demonstrated a software process that leveraged model-based code generation with system build and later Simulink with a modular, loosely coupled publish and subscribe infrastructure, namely Goddard's Core Flight Executive, CFE. This process was further refined when we started on the Laddie spacecraft. To give you the big picture, here's the flight software architecture for Laddie. Notice on the top, the yellow lollipops are Simulink-generated apps. The blue ones are general-purpose Goddard-provided CFE and CFS apps. And the green ones are the ones that we're writing to talk to hardware that implement specific protocols for communicating with the hardware through the lower-level device drivers. And more specific for this talk, we'll be focusing on what we call the hardware I/O apps. There's several of them for the different sensors, actuators, and the payloads. Some of them implement protocols such as SLIP or CCSDS packet utilization standard and other custom protocols. So the hardware I/O modules know the protocol that needs to be talked, but they don't take care of any of the transport layer. Okay, now let's talk about the various test beds that we're using. The first one is not that interesting from a real-time perspective. It's the workstation simulation. This is executed inside of Simulink, and the transports are basically done through Simulink wires, specifically Simulink non-virtual buses, which get auto-coded out to C-structs, which get embedded into CFE messages, and that's how the different apps can get data off the software bus, off the CFE software bus. This is the lowest fidelity transport, obviously. Then the next higher fidelity that we have that we needed early on was a processor in the loop simulation. Mind you, this isn't a real flight processor. In our case, the RAD 750. Wasn't available yet. This is just a 750 processor, a PowerPC, that was binary compatible with the RAD 750. So early on, we could start compiling and running code on that. And this came in two flavors. One flavor was one processor with both the simulation and the flight software running. In that case, the transport is a shared memory. Then we have what we call the two-pill, which is two processors, one processor for the flight software, another processor for the simulation, and we use an Ethernet protocol for the transport. An earlier prototype used a VME chassis where we had two processors and shared memory, but we haven't been using that, the VME lately. We've gone to CPCI. Okay, then finally there's the hardware in the loop called the Hill. This is the highest fidelity transport available. It's the actual electronic signals generated, and it's and expected by flight avionics I/O boards. The RS422 analog I/O, digital I/O, power and propulsion solar array controller boards are physically connected to complementary I/O boards on the test interface controller. It's called the TIC in the diagram there. And that's where the sim lives. So for example, in the Hill, to turn on a device, the flight software writes an internal message to the SACI device, the solar array controller board. That causes a power board to output 28 volts, which if connected to an actual instrument or sensor would turn it on, could turn on an IMU or a star tracker or something. The 28 volts in this case is detected by a digital I/O board on the TIC and then transformed into a power on software bus message that the EPS sim application can receive and feed into the rest of the simulation. However, also important for early integration is a hybrid version of the pill and the hill, affectionately called Phil or sometimes the mini hill. Here we have a flight processor, a network card, which obviously we're not going to fly, and a subset of the avionics I/O boards. In this instance, the power and propulsion boards are not present. Instead, the internal flight software message to those boards would be transported to the sim via Ethernet. The message that would have, in the example of turning on a device like we talked about before, the internal SACI message, instead of going to hardware, would now go over Ethernet to a simulation hardware I/O application. The simulation hardware I/O would have to interpret the SACI message and then do some magic to generate the same software bus message with the EPS for the EPS sim that told it to turn something on. So this mix and match became important because some of the hardware was available. Like we had the RAD 750, we had a DEMOAB. These are broad reach boards, and we had some of their analog boards, but we didn't have the power boards yet. We wanted to start doing something, but we didn't want to diverge too much from the software path that we were on. We wanted to keep the hardware I/O modules binary compatible with the final version of the hardware I/O modules. So that leads us to what were some of the goals that we wanted for this system, for the test beds. The main goal, of course, of a closed-loop test bed is to make the flight software algorithms think that they're flying. Beyond that, on LADEE, we wanted an early integration of all modules, including the hardware I/O modules. This necessitated an evolutionary approach to test bed integration, meaning a mix and match of real avionics boards with emulated transports. To make this evolution manageable, all apps, including the hardware I/O apps, needed to be the same on all targets. That is the one pill, the two pill, or the hill, or the mix and match fill. The next slide shows what code could look like if they weren't the same. Okay, this would be an example of some pseudocode that shows a star tracker app. It's trying to read data from a star tracker, parse it into a message that it can put on the software bus that the Simulink state estimator can receive and know what to do with. So in this example, we're not binary compatible because we have three different preprocessor macros. If you set the one pill, it's going to read shared memory. If you set the two pill preprocessor macro, it'll read from a socket. Otherwise, it'll read from some message queue that a device driver at interrupt level is writing to. and that would be what you'd fly with and use in the hill. So in order to implement a mix and match in this with this type of code, the pre-compiler flags would have to be set differently for each hardware I/O app. That would make the build and install process difficult to manage at best. So this is a route we didn't want to go down. So looking at a more portable approach that might facilitate the fill mix and match evolution, we decided to go with POSIX I/O API. In this case, the way this works is it's you open a named device, then you read write to it by a file descriptor that was returned from the open, and that's about it. So your app can write in an opaque way without really knowing what the hardware is. Okay, and then some of the advantages of using this POSIX API are, the main advantage is that the transport is completely encapsulated in the driver. And the hardware I/O modules can run on any target, making it easy to manage builds. And since POSIX device drivers can be loaded and unloaded at runtime, the mix and match of transports becomes a lot easier. It's not a compile time thing. It can be done at runtime when it determines what hardware is available. Okay, so here's an example with using the same code using the POSIX I/O API. Let's take a look there. I guess it's opening this ST device, that's Star Tracker, and then it's adding that file descriptor to a set. And then in its loop, it's doing a select, one of the other methods of the POSIX API, which makes it block until there's some activity on the file descriptor. Not only that, it could be waiting for multiple file descriptors, perhaps. So when it wakes up, it does the FD set functionality to see if that activity was for the Star Tracker. If it is, it reads from the file descriptor into a buffer, parses the buffer to create the software bus message, and then publishes that message for the state estimator. So another advantage of this using the POSIX API is that this module can be tested standalone with just a file feeding it inputs. And for that matter, it doesn't have to run on VxWorks. It could be running on Linux or some other operating system, assuming that the parse device message has all the endianism features built into it if you're on an Intel platform as opposed to a PowerPC. And conversely, on the simulation side, one of the goals was to utilize the same infrastructure, CFE and simulate-generated code on the sim side. So the simulation part of that would look very much the same. In this case, though, it would be writing to the Star Tracker device. It would be actually receiving a message from the simulated Star Tracker off the software bus, parsing it, just reading it, because it's all just there as a C struct, and then creating a device message that looks like it came from the Star Tracker, and then finally writing it to that file descriptor. Okay, so a summary of the API. There's six basic functions: open, read, write, IOCTL, close, and select. The OS uses the file descriptor to map your read or write calls to the proper functions based on how you opened it and got a file descriptor back. The other interesting thing here is the IOCTL. That's kind of the catch-all for anything specific that you want to do to a device that you may not be doing to other devices. It's an opaque interface for getting or setting attributes of your device. Some examples in serial programming would be setting a baud rate. And the spacecraft could be setting like downlink rates. Some cases there's heartbeat counters we want to get to from a payload, for example, or setting start addresses, stop addresses, and that sort of thing. Developing a POSIX driver is also not that difficult. It just involves implementing the five functions. You don't have to implement select. That's done by the operating system. So for your device, you just write an open, close, read, write in an ILCTL. In a way, this is a pure C implementation of object-oriented concepts such as polymorphism and inheritance. The polymorphism is basically you're giving these callbacks to the operating system, and it's calling the proper ones when the application based on how it opened and got back the descriptor. And there's some inheritance because the dev struct actually has structs inside of a struct that the operating system knows about, so you get some type of inheritance there. And this interface application, this API has been around for quite a while, probably before C++ was invented, surely before Java was invented. And I didn't mention that you also have to install your driver by giving it pointers to all those functions. So in summary, the LADEE rapid development methodologies called for early and frequent integration of all apps. This early integration meant that we needed a mix and match evolution of device transports. The POSIX.io driver approach allowed manageable development of evolving mix and match test beds. So I think I blazed through that pretty quickly. Are there any questions? Thank you.
Of the HST NISKI flight software team, which is part of the larger payload flight software team. And I'm going to be talking today about how we repurposed an existing design to create a general purpose telemetry monitor for HST. The Hubble Space Telescope has been operating for 21 years with continuous ground support. We took a proven design and modified it to provide an autonomous telemetry monitor. I'll be talking about the advantages and the disadvantages, what we did right and the mistakes we made. First, some background. HST is a mix of old and new technology. We have science instruments on board that are state-of-the-art. They communicate to the rest of the spacecraft through the science instrument command and data handler, which we call the SICNDH. An important part of the SICNDH is the NASA standard spacecraft computer, Model 1, which we refer to as NISKI. The NISKI is good, solid 1970s technology. The on-orbit SICNDH, the original SICNDH, was replaced with a flight spare that had been sitting in a clean room for 20 years during the last servicing mission. But that is another story. The NISKI is programmed in NISKI assembly language, and we have many executive programs that have been inherited from earlier NISKI missions. This is a high-level schematic of our SICNDH. We have the CPU, which, because Hubble has to rename everything, we call it CPM. And four memory modules. Each one of those memory modules has 64K words of memory. Now, we can only use one of those at a time. The other three are spares. We also see the five science instruments. That's where the real work of Hubble gets done. The NISKI's job is to support that work. The problem is, we'd been doing continuous ground support, and we needed to move to autonomous operation. And in fact, we did go to autonomous operation
on June 13th of this year. Planning for this began before the last servicing mission. We needed an onboard autonomous anomaly response in order to minimize the time between anomaly and response. We needed to avoid flight ops team involvement in routine events, and we needed to reduce the dependence on downlink telemetry for anomaly response. We had one requirement going into this. HST automation system shall provide the ability to respond to specific spacecraft anomalies, a very high-level requirement that had nothing levied on our flight software. We did have two existing monitoring applications on board. We had the MF Montelem, the Executive Telemetry Monitor Processor. That limit checks up to 22 telemetry item. It will post a status message when limits are exceeded 5 times in a row. And it will also safe the payload if it sees the loss of the 1 megahertz clock. All its actions are hard-coded, and it runs once a minute. We also had a general-purpose event flag processor, MFGPEF. This monitors up to 16 NISQI addresses. They don't have to be telemetry items. And it will set or clear one of 90 event flags when an action is required. There's 15 event flags that are global, and then there's 15 for each of the 5 science instruments. These event flags can then be used to control stored command sequences. And the actions of this processor are controlled by a programmable table, and it runs every half second. We had one choice would be to move ahead with no onboard flight software changes. In this case, we would use the status messages from MF Montelem, and the ground system would then take autonomous actions. The problem there is these status messages are potentially transient and may not be visible due to telemetry limitations. We could also use the event flag processor, which will set the event flags that could then be used to control continuously running command sequences. And we can have a continuously running command sequence for each command processor. The problem here is that these actions would then be tightly coupled, even though they'd otherwise be independent. What we chose to do was to make an onboard change. My coworker, Dr. Francis Schiffer, realized that our event flag processor had most of the functionality we were looking for. All we had to do was make setting an event flag optional, increase the number of programmable slots from 16 to 32, and allow this to activate a command sequence. Because the functionality was already there, this would have been a fairly simple update. But during design review, it was decided that this was inadequate. Instead, it was decided that we would create a new AP, the General Purpose Telemetry Monitor, MFGPTM, and that would be run in addition to the current monitors that were already running on orbit. Among other additions, we added new actions in addition to activating stored command sequences, and we would allow multiple actions per slot. So moving forward, we took the event flag table, cloned it, and modified it. There are 10 words, and we for each slot, and we increased the slots from 16 to 32. We used spare fields for the 6 new fields we needed, added to the existing 12 fields. We added new actions, safing, activation of RTCS, sending of event messages, and setting of event flags. And we also added the ability to set which minor frame this would start on, and we added some new sub-track modes. We had to modify the meaning of 2 of our existing fields. For the event flag, for the event flag processor, you had to select a flag. Now, 0 is a legal value, so you can disable that choice. And we also had to expand the definition of science instrument number because safing and RTCS had special requirements. We also modularized the logic of the telemetry monitor processor. The event flag processor was fairly simple and linear. We divided telemetry monitor processor into 5 subroutines. In summary, we added to the basic design but didn't change it. This is our event flag table. We have a frequency counter programmable in 5-second increments up to 68 minutes. That's a frequency that a slot would be processed. We have a couple internal counters, the NISCI address, bit mask for that address, high and low limits, the event flag for setting the event flags, science instrument number, the type of checking to be done, either taking an action on in limits condition or taking action on out of limits condition. And then in addition, we can have a one-shot latching or a tracking of a value over time. And finally, the minimum consecutive times that you see something needing an action before the limit criteria is met before taking an action. So we added new fields. We have a safing field, one bit to decide whether or not we're going to take the action to safe. 1 to 144 to activate a specific stored command sequence. A one bit to decide whether or not we're going to post a status buffer message to the ground. A bit to decide whether we're going to set a status report flag. A bit to determine a new flavor of tracking, whether the tracking will be continuous while the action is required or only on transition into that action, and the optional first minor frame to sample, which will allow us to actually look at subcommutated telemetry. And as I said earlier, we had to change the meaning of 2 event fields, or 2 fields from the event flag processor. This is our data structure, the way the fields are actually packed in NISCI memory. We have 18-bit words, 10 words per slot, and the red fields are new for the general purpose telemetry monitor. The yellow are our internal counters. Whoops, yeah. The yellow are our internal counters that aren't programmed. They're just used by the program itself. The advantages we found of design reuse. We have a quicker transition into development. Much of the desired functionality was already present. We could reuse existing tests, and we could reuse operational procedures and data structures. Finally, we had an existing knowledge base from the real-world usage of the general purpose event flag processor. These are the disadvantages we encountered in our design reuse. We had limited requirements analysis of the existing functionality. We discovered that our old test scripts, some of them, required extensive reworking before they would run in our current test environment. And finally, the schedule assumed there was only the agreed upon modifications would be added, but there was requirements creep. We had derived requirements added to the design. Timing was a concern. It was decided that we needed to stagger the activation of RTCSs to reduce the processing load. NISCI processing is controlled by a scheduler table, which evens out that load. It was feared that if a number of stored commands were activated at one time, we could upset that balance. Another concern about stored commands was nesting. If one RTCS was already active and a new RTCS activation could cause that first RTCS to nest. And this would be a concern if you had a sequence of commands that needed to be issued together or within a limited amount of time. And finally, we needed to finish all our processing of all the slots before the next minor timing pulse, which runs on a 500 millisecond cycle. We had requirements slipped in as minor modifications. Error checking when a slot was initialized, that was what we planned. But it was also decided that we needed to do error checking of the slot at action time. It was decided we needed to take stronger action to prevent RTCS nesting. We would only activate an RTCS if no other RTCS was active for that SI. The slot, if the activation was delayed, that slot would remain active until it could be activated. We also had to synchronize monitoring to telemetry. We added the optional first minor frame field. This allows checking of the subcommutated telemetry, and it also allows us to program the slots to make more efficient use of resources. And finally, we added two new tracking modes. The transition mode, which only invokes a stored command or sends an ESB message on transition into the action state, and a continuous mode for tracking, which will continuously invoke an RTCS or send an ESB while we're in the action state. This is a high-level view of the overall program structure. Our original proposal, we were going to modify the general purpose event flag processor and add a new subroutine for the action response. And as I said, we needed to create a new AP. The event flag processor remained unchanged, and we have the general purpose telemetry monitor, its subroutines, and because we added a new AP, we now also had to modify our scheduler table. And late in testing, we discovered we had a design error. We had to break out the event flag processing, which had been part of the main process, into its own subroutine. What went wrong? Modifications were made to the design without identifying changes to the requirements. There was no step back to re-examine the overall design in light of the changed requirements. Our unit tests matched the original flawed design. As a result, design errors slipped through, errors that weren't caught until we ran a more rigorous system test. What were the design errors? They were related to a number of these new requirements. Continuous tracking. It generated actions whether or not actions were triggered. It turned out we needed to move the event flag code to a separate subroutine so that we could handle those actions in a different manner than we were handling the new actions. Tracking could cause the consecutive counter to wrap. This caused actions to be unexpectedly triggered. We fixed this by setting the consecutive counter to a value of 2 after tracking limits were satisfied. This provided a ceiling beyond the meaningful values of 0 and 1, which are all that you would expect to see in tracking. And finally, if in tracking mode we failed to activate an RTCS because another RTCS was active, that RTCS would never be activated. In this case, we needed to reset the consecutive counter to 0 so that the program knew that the RTCS had not yet been activated. This was a double impact to our schedule. It created much more work than was originally estimated. Flight software had to be modified and retested late in the development process. Our symbol of interest, which maps flight software variables to physical memory addresses, had already been delivered to the project database. Now, I have to say here that for HST, the project database and flight software deliveries are tightly linked. Is this change to the SOI after delivery a big problem? Yes. Creating a new project database is an exacting process. It requires a long lead time. We did not have that time. And of course, this was all found in mid-December. Happy holidays. So, long before we had got to that stage, when we were in the initial coding, we added the MFGPTM to the end of NISCI memory. The linking of the assembled code is controlled by a linker map. And so we added this code to the end of memory, making sure that the new table was in front, so that when we did have this code change to make, it did not affect any old symbols, only new symbols, and it didn't affect any of the new symbols that were needed operationally. This is our NISCI standard development process, and this is what we actually did. Now, in the design review phase, that's where we also review our requirements. Code and unit testing is typically done by the same team member. System testing is usually handed off to a different team member. But at this point, we were shorthanded. The same team member also did the system test. During review of that system test, it was deemed barely adequate, but we had to get that SOI delivered. We passed it with the caveat that after the SOI delivery, that test would be redesigned and rerun. It was during the initial runs of that redesigned test that we discovered our big problems. What did we learn from all this? We need to identify requirement changes implied by changes made during design reviews, and we need to review the entire design, not just the new parts of the design, in light of requirement changes. In the few minutes I have left, I'd like to talk about some of the uses of the general purpose telemetry monitor. It will be able to replace tasks that have been done by special purpose stored command sequences. It will also reduce the need for ground operations monitoring of telemetry. Currently, it's executing on orbit with an empty table while HST operations personnel develop and validate actual slot definitions to be used on orbit. And in fact, that is actually in process. I also included three programming examples. The first one is an emulation of what our MF Montelem processor does. It looks at the no 1 megahertz clock flag, and if that flag is set 5 times in a row, it will safe the payload. Safing is the only action set here. And because this is latching, the frequency will be set to zero and will have to be reset by the ground. Of course, since we're also safing the payload, that's kind of irrelevant in this case. This is a slightly more complicated case. Here we're programming two slots to monitor the same telemetry. We have, in the N plus 2 slot, we have yellow limits, and in the N plus 1 slot, we have red limits. For the yellow limits, our only action is to post an ESB. For the red limits, we're posting in the ESB to the ground, we're setting an event flag, an error flag, and we're also activating an RTCS, which in this case will turn off the science data formatter. And again, since this is latching, if either of these slots trigger, then the frequency will be set to zero and have to be reset by the ground. Finally, this is the case that is nearest and dearest to my heart. A single bit error. We have a single bit error flag in our new NISCI CMOS memory that lets us know whenever the EDAC function has found and fixed a single bit flip. And it's a purely informational flag. It comes down in telemetry. Our old NISCI had core memory. That memory didn't know the South Atlantic anomaly existed. Our new CMOS memory seems to trigger every time we go through the SAA, but operations quickly decided they were bored with resetting the flag, and so we don't really know how many of these single bit errors we're getting per orbit. We created a looping RTCS similar to what I mentioned earlier. which would have been controlled by the general purpose event flag processor, and tested it and validated it, and that would have cleared this single bit error flag, but it was never flown on orbit. So this will provide us a quick and simple way to trigger a very short stored command sequence that will activate, clear the flag, and then turn off until the next time it's needed. In conclusion, design reuse has distinct advantages. The design is already tested and understood. A user knowledge base already exists. Test scripts already exist. A reuse design should be treated as new in terms of requirements analysis and testing. Minor changes can have unexpected design implications. Thank you. Finally, my own plug, please remember to design for future maintainability. You never know. The code that you're designing for a five-year mission to boldly go where no one has gone before could still be operating 30 years from now. This is a detail of one of our vintage hardware boards that we use for testing our software. Are there any questions? I just have to say that unlike wine, vintage hardware doesn't get better, it just gets older.
My name is Claire Hopkins. I'm here to present the results of model-based flight software Pathfinder that was developed by Lockheed Martin last year. So what was the Pathfinder? It was an internal R&D project sponsored by the Lockheed Martin Space Vehicle Integration Lab. It was intended to demonstrate a model-based approach toward developing flight software. This approach had been used by the SVIL for some time, but it had never really been validated. It was still somewhat controversial as to whether there were any efficiency gains or advantages to using a model-based approach. So this was intended to actually compare that approach against the traditional heritage methods of using text-based documentation and design. Okay, so it accomplished three goals for us. That was, it successfully demonstrated a model-based approach towards developing flight software. Using automated source code generation from graphical modeling tools and targeted specifically towards flight-qualified processors. It addressed each phase of the software lifecycle from software architecture all the way up through integration and test, and produced a large body of evidence to both to compare against the heritage method and also to provide good bases of estimates for use in incorporating model-based design into proposals. So the rationale for using model-based design in the first place is that it reduces risk and cost by driving down the time spent in development. It also produces more flexible products in that models are easier to work with, easier to modify and change than source code by itself. And they're also more readable. It provides better techniques for managing your design information in that design artifacts persist throughout the life cycle of the process. So you'll never have that disconnect between what you implement and what you have designed. The design itself actually generates the implementation. So you never have to go back and change things. If your design review changes, it's persisted throughout your earlier models as well. This also provides better support for practical reuse. Since models are easier to look at and understand, they can be more easily passed off to other team members to work with or to modify. It's easier to find what you need to change, where functionality exists, and a great advantage is that it's not bound to a specific programming language. So if your DNC is written in Ada for some reason and your requirements change on a following program and you need it to be written in C, you'd have to totally rewrite that or find some other way to interface with it. Whereas with a model, all you have to do is change a flag and regenerate your code. It also reduces a lot of defects in that the requirements analysis is more functionally based from user stories, so there's a lot more analytical rigor going into it. Also, support by tools such as Simulink allows quick early prototyping so that you can identify defects early on in the life cycle, making them easier to fix, less cost, because, you know, as we know, it gets exponentially more expensive the later on you find defects. There we go. So the objectives of the Pathfinder were first to actually leverage the model-based system design to increase productivity, to develop code quickly and high quality, and to reduce the software risk, to demonstrate the fundamental tenets, kind of provide a little bit of a gold standard for an efficient model-based approach to flight software development. And these are modeling maturity, especially in model-driven architecture, kind of the start to finish use of modeling instead of introducing it late in the process. Using graphical models and domain-specific languages, and the automation of coding and testing. Then we need to compare all of this for the software lifecycle activities against a heritage approach. So what's the actual concrete differences between using the heritage approach and using the model-based approach? So we needed to collect and report a lot of different measures, concrete measures, as well as general sort of subjective measures of readability and reusability. And to kind of validate the use of MBSD in flight software development. And then finally, to reduce supporting products and documentation for this so that it could be used in future programs. So we needed to create a modeling methods guidebook, templates for writing bases of estimates and metrics for proposing activities, and really importantly, identify shortfalls and pitfalls and ways to mitigate and work around them. So the process that we followed was to develop incremental subsets of flight software. We chose the GNNC and EPS domains for this work and had two independent engineers working on each different domain independently from each other, so we could have kind of more data between them. Instead of collaborating, they were each their own data points. And we specifically chose engineers that had no experience at all with the tools that we were using. So one of the characteristics that we really wanted to analyze was how easy it would be to introduce new engineers to this process, since if it is new, not a lot of people are going to be all that familiar with it. So on the model-based side, we started out using just UML and Rhapsody for both architecture and requirements for both GNC and EPS. And then when we got to the design implementation phases, we split them out, and GNC used domain-specific tools, specifically Simulink, that supported fully auto-generated code and automated test vectors. And then for the EPS, it was more of a general object-oriented analysis and design tools using UML with Rhapsody. So there was sort of a semi-automatic generation of code, but some details still needed to be filled in by hand. So on the heritage side, they were both gone through the same method of just writing documents and making drawings with Microsoft Office and completely hand-generating all the code. Okay, once that was done, we had to compare the approaches using both quantitative and qualitative measures. So while we were doing the development, detailed metrics were taken at each phase. And whenever a phase was finished, there were design reviews, trying to get some qualitative, kind of subjective measures from experts onto the quality of the products. As we went along, we kind of tried to document lessons learned and to kind of measure the trends from one increment to the next. So like I said, the learning curve was one of the things that we really tracked. So finally, at the end, when we had all the code developed, we had to integrate and test, both find defects and kind of do some benchmarking, learn if efficiency was any different between the two approaches. We passed it off, actually, to an independent group to do the unit testing. And one of the important things was there was leveraging features of the automatic test production for MBSD. Do some functional verification again by the independent group, and then finally integrate the code and run it on our flight qualified processors to get benchmarks. So these are some of our modeling tools up here, kind of screens from what we did. Let's see if I have, there we go. So this is a Simulink here on the left. We have our block diagrams and scopes for monitoring data over wires during simulation. On the right, we have the Rhapsody side. So it's use case diagrams and class diagrams, and both of these would be used for actually generating the code. This really busy screen kind of lays out the artifacts that you would see in a totally integrated MBSD approach. So at the top, we're kind of starting with DODAF models from the spacecraft or system of systems level. And that kind of flows down and narrows down till it switches over to the UML and SysML side with systems engineering. Those then would get flowed down to more specific software systems engineering, and then finally into the domain-specific modeling or the object-oriented UML for the actual design and implementation. So this the whole green section here was the focus of the Pathfinder that we did in 2010. The second Pathfinder was kind of sent, I'm not talking about that today, but it was meant to explore different tools. So LabVIEW is another thing that the SVIL uses. And so we meant to get some metrics on that as well. So the focus was definitely on the software engineering side. That was what metrics were taken for the inputs to it, to try and get that kind of integrated approach. We took systems engineering inputs from an actual program that was using heritage documentation. So that's what we got for the heritage side. And then prior to the start of the actual Pathfinder activities, we took those same inputs and translated them into modeling artifacts. So kind of get that realistic sense of passing down the models through the production. So we used the good paradigms for doing that. We just didn't take any metrics on it since we didn't have the metrics of how the heritage documentation was produced. So our schedule out there, it was a fairly short program. The last couple of months of 2009 was the detailed planning. 2010 was when the systems engineering inputs were collected and then switched into modeling artifacts. And then from March, we kicked off and all through November, went through the software lifecycle, collecting metrics and concurrently sort of developing the SDP and the BOE estimates there. Finally, early 2010, we did our testing and wrapped up and collected our metrics. So in context, we're kind of defining development here as everything from architecture through implementation, which in the total lifecycle of these of this program was only about 48%. And the rest of it was test and verification sent off to an independent group. So we kind of use these measurements to weight our metrics later on. So when we say, there was whatever decrease in architecture, we then put that in the context of how long it takes to do architecture in a life cycle. So these were the raw hours of our development, kind of averaged over the engineers working on them. We have the EPS heritage there versus the modeling side, and the GNC versus its modeling side there. It's kind of an overview. You can see they're color-coded, so we have the architecture pieces and then requirements and how long they took. Design in yellow and then implementation in aqua. So the thing that really jumps out early on is that we saved a lot on GNC, doing it with modeling versus heritage using Simulink. Big notices were like a shift between implementation and design. But anyways, we'll kind of talk about that in a minute. So these are our results really broken down. For the reductions that we saw for each phase, and then how that fit into an overall lifecycle savings. So architecture between the model base from the heritage baseline. So the metrics we took for the heritage kind of made our start, and then saw the difference between that and the modeling. So architecture, we ended up with about a 12% reduction using modeling. Unfortunately, that only results in about a 1% savings overall. Requirements actually increased, averaged over EPS and GNC. We kind of don't consider that too much of a bad thing. It ended up being a 2% increase, but we figured that that was sort of indicative of the greater rigor that was lent to the requirements process. So design and implementation ended up being so coupled between them that we combined those two. But they are split out into the Simulink and the UML processes. Simulink saw a huge reduction in the time spent. It was 32%. Making for a 23% reduction overall. With UML, we saw actually an increase in the time spent in design and implementation and an overall product increase in time of 8%. And that was largely due to the difference in the learning curves. We'll kind of talk about that in a minute, but learning Rhapsody is no simple task, or at least learning to make it do what you want you to do. So. Anyway, so moving on to test, we again saw a huge reduction using Simulink for automated test because it does support that from your design, automating of test vectors to test your code. With UML, what you have for testing, since it doesn't support that kind of feature, there was no difference. You basically had source code that you handed the testers for both sides. Unfortunately, what we're missing from this, at the time the Pathfinder was happening, ALF, which is the action language for functional UML, was actually currently being developed, which would do that for us. If it had been supported, it would do the same sort of automatic generation of test vectors. So we kind of took some measurements there when we could. They're not as precise, but trying to figure out exactly what we would have saved if we'd been able to do that. So anyways, with the formula verification and qualification, taking our results and comparing them to the requirements and doing that, again, Simulink was better. UML was a little bit better, but our final results for development, just between architecture and implementation, was a 22% reduction in cost for Simulink and an 8% increase for UML. So including testing and validation and all of that, we ended up with a total 39% reduction in cost for Simulink. UML saw a 7% increase. We do figure, through some magic figuring, that if we'd been able to use that test vector generation, we could eventually work up to having an 8% reduction in cost for just using generic UML. And then an important factor, too, is our defect and error reduction for both saw a 44% and a 50% decrease, an improvement. So eliminating a lot of the cost of rework. So through all of this, we kind of took some observations and our lessons learned. It turns out that cost productivity savings was a lot better if you have a larger code increment. So there's a certain amount of overhead involved in doing the UML and doing the modeling. So if you have a larger code increment, that kind of evens out and you get savings out of it eventually. But you do need a little bit of a larger code increment for that to work. Talking about the automated document generation was also a nice feature, and that was available in both Rhapsody and Simulink. And that kind of drove down the cost of our architecture. Like I mentioned, the process rigor and requirements analysis we found to be more strenuous. And the design effort ended up being longer than the model-based effort as well, because implementation really kind of starts taking a back seat. Since the implementation is basically generated by the design, we spent a lot more time on that. The testing effort was drastically reduced for domain-specific modeling. And like I say, if we had the executable modeling languages supported by your tools, then we could find those savings as well. And qualitatively, we found that the modeling gave us kind of more encapsulated code. It was more nicely packaged. It could be more easily reused and passed off to other people. On the other hand, using static analysis becomes more strenuous. It's harder to look through. But then the other side of that, too, is it's easier to read and debug. Not that auto-generated code is ever particularly easy to read, but the models are. So the documentation was better, we found. The benefit to the persistence of the original architecture models through design implementation were very, very nice. We kept everything consistent. The test planning for the verification was easier because the models were easier to understand. And we kind of fulfilled a good goal of shifting work to the left of the product timeline. So that whole thing about where you find your defects being farther over and earlier in the life cycle was very nice. We did find that the tool maturity issues really hampered us a lot. The Rational Rhapsody is fragile. I don't know if anybody has experience working with that, but we found it very frustrating trying to get it to generate code the way we wanted it to. So we've reported issues that we found, and we're hopefully the tool maturity will get better over time, or Lockheed will switch to other tools. We used Rhapsody because it was an industry standard. So the caveats we found was that the learning curve was significant. Since we all started from square one, it took a long time to kind of get over that hump. But as you grew more comfortable with the tools, development time increased over the incremental subsets by about 2 to 3 times. So if we had experienced engineers, they could be a lot more productive with the model-based code versus the heritage as well, since we were all actually experienced with heritage processing. And the huge caveat we found was code efficiency was much worse, about 2 to 3 times for model-based versus for their auto-generated code. And there was a bloat factor of about 2.5 for the SLOC, We're hopeful that optimizations and features in the tools could help kind of mitigate this. We've learned since then about other features of the real-time workshop attached to Simulink that helps you bring that down, but that is the case, and that's always going to be the case. So in conclusion, we think we've proved that it reduces risk and cost of developing flight software in general. The 39% reduction from Heritage using Simulink is definitely non-negligible. And the UML modeling results in a small increase, but we think with experience and more tool maturity, that can definitely be helpful, and the testing and verification will improve. And we have those qualitative benefits that you just have to take our word on about it being modular and readable. It's important to use the right tools. Domain-specific tools, whenever possible, are definitely helpful, and using executable UML. And automatic unit testing is very important as well. Your schedule is going to have to account for learning curve if you have first-time developers. And you have to be able to account for that loss of execution efficiency. That might be okay for your program, but you do have to understand that it's going to be there. So in general, you know, our way forward is just to kind of keep investigating, keep pushing the tool development, and see where it goes from here. So that's what I got. I've got to be close on time. But yeah, questions?
Can you quantify that? You said the execution efficiency is lower. Can you quantify that in any way?
I want to say it was about twice as bad. Between 1.5 and twice. Running them like a million runs of the integrated process, it was a difference between, I don't know, like 40 and 50 milliseconds or something like that. Between like 40 and 50, then 40 and 80. It was kind of in that range.
Okay. Do you have a feeling for what types of code are inefficient and which types of code might not be as inefficient?
For the generated code?
Yeah.
There are some things that we discovered. One of the other things that made the code inefficient was an excess of number of system calls. So that depends on your modeling process as well. So you kind of have this exchange of modeling detail versus modeling efficiency. So Rhapsody includes a lot of things like ports and interfaces that you can make use of. It's very modular, it's very object-oriented, but it does create more overhead with the system calls. So if you can kind of pare that down and kind of play to your compiler strengths, then I think that would be much better.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Other questions?
Over here.
Hi, I'm curious why you decided that the end of the software lifecycle is integration and test.
For what the developers were doing. So that was kind of the focus of the Pathfinder. You mean as opposed to?
After it actually gets used.
Ah, the unfortunate thing about this is that this code did not get used. So, I mean, we did the best we could with that situation being the case. Like I say, it was from a real program that was currently in development, and they had to move on irrespective of our schedule.
Is that how you decided on the defect reduction and error reduction?
That was the testers going through, comparing against some of our coding standards, against common errors you'd find in static analysis, that kind of thing. So we had to kind of quantify that in some way.
One of the topics that was addressed earlier was fault management. Is that included in your model at your higher levels, or?
No, it wasn't. We couldn't get that detailed.
Yeah.
It turned out since we had to implement all of these basically twice in several different ways, it would have been beyond the scope of the project to include that.
Yeah, I'm just thinking that might be a little bit harder to implement in models than...
It might. So. It depends. The OOAD is still, I find it incredibly useful to at least to organize your project. At least I know some of our other developers use Simulink more heavily and might have more experience with using fault management, but yeah.
Other questions?
Nope. Yeah, a few series of questions. When you generate the test vector, did you purely rely on Simulink, or you have any human intervene to generate the test vectors?
I think it's mostly Simulink. It has to be kind of verified by a human tester. But it is mostly auto-generated.
Right. So you just let them generate the test vectors?
I believe so.
Okay.
And I know for the other side, like I say, both subsets were implemented both ways. So they had to compare that against what they did for the handwritten code for the GNC as well.
Okay. Another question is regarding the code efficiencies. How did you generate the code? Like what options?
Oof.
Obviously there are a lot of options in there the embedded coder. For which also, are you purely rely on Simulink provide blocks to generate the code? Or do you have your own library for the code generation purpose?
It's the Simulink functionality. It's the real time workshop that they have, so it's real time safe code.
But in general, I mean, I would say cutting edge practice or some optimized mm-hmm. process. I believe your Orion program also did the same way, generating the specific library for the code generation, mm-hmm. so you can have a duplicatable code and also more optimized code than Simulink. And like 2.5 times of efficiency, that's kind of hard to believe.
The 2.5 times is the code bloat, not necessarily the efficiency.
Well, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, actually, that's even harder to believe. Because in my experience, even that's even a 5-year-old mm-hmm. technology with the Simulink version 6.3,
mm-hmm.
it's about like 20% overhead.
That's not
because
bad.
We use our own library to generate the code.
Yeah.
And also, latest claim by MathWorks, as of April this year,
mm-hmm.
their slug is about 85% to the hand coding. That's their claim.
It depends. I mean, right. It depends on what you use
like
and how many comments.
2.5 times
in.
Kind of a
it is
big
a lot.
Numbers.
And that is kind of a rough estimate, even including
so
comments.
So I think, I believe you are just purely rely on Simulink blocks. For example, in the integrator,
mm-hmm.
if you're using a continuous time into the discrete time, it'll generate overhead in RK4 or whatever the algorithm you're using it.
Mm-hmm.
So, at
least if you want to consider this a worst case example, there are definitely ways to make it better. So, yeah.
Hey, thank you.
Thanks. Okay.
Okay, any other questions? Yes, Chris?
For a long time, nobody let a compiler write an arithmetic expression for them because they weren't very good.
Mm-hmm.
But nowadays, they are as good as most, better than most human programmers. And my guess is that these code generation modeling languages are aiming in that direction and might eventually get there. So it's something that, you know, they're not quite ready for it yet, but they will be.
Right. I think you're right. So hopefully anyway. All right.
Five people, 6 months to complete the FMEA of a system, and because of the sheer amount of work involved, it's usually only done once during the detailed design phase of the system. So we thought, well, if we automate the process, then FMEA could be generated faster and have significant benefits. For example, we could run the FMEA multiple times during the software design life cycle, and which is then enable early identification of potential problems. So instead of doing it once, normally doing a critical design phase, you can do it throughout the life cycle phase and find problems early. Next slide. So this chart shows the differences between a traditionally manually generated FMEA and the output created by our current tools. Among the differences are the item and failure mode in a manual analysis consists of a single component failing in a specific way, whereas in the automated approach, it's the configuration of a system which then fails in a certain way. So if all components are initially in a working state, then there's really no difference between the two methods. However, if the starting state is degraded, basically what this means is it has already experienced some kind of failure, then there is a difference between our method and the traditional method. And that's about it. So I'll go into more detail about this in the next few slides. So slide 6 kind of compares the results that we get from manually doing FMEA and automatically doing FMEA. I don't want to go into all these details, but basically the important point that I want to make is that the main difference is in the number of effects and number of failures that we look at. In a FMEA that's generated manually, we normally look at about maybe 2 to 3 effects, meaning that we look at the immediate effect and then at the system level effect. Whereas in our tool, we can look at effects. The number of effects that we can look at is basically unlimited. We can see how a failure would propagate from a single component all the way out to the rest of the components in the system. In addition, the other main difference is the number of failures. As I kind of stated earlier before, in the manual FMEA, we usually look at a system whose starting state has not suffered a failure already, basically perfect. Whereas in our tool, we can look at all failure modes can analyze simultaneous failures or multiple failures in a single failure mode. So that's basically it for the kind of high-level overview of what FMEA is. Slide 7, please. So now I'll go over quickly the AADL language. AADL stands for Architecture Analysis and Design Language. It was developed by the Society of Automotive Engineers. It is a standard, and it provides a textual and graphical notation for describing software and hardware system architectures and their interfaces. The standard AADL language is basically used to model the architecture of a system, software and hardware. However, over the years, people have developed annexes to the language, and so we can also describe the program behavior using the behavior annex, and we can describe the failure and recovery behavior using the error annex. The error annex will be the focus of this presentation, as that is the annex we use to generate our FMEAs. I'll describe event ports, guards, and propagations later on in this presentation. Next slide, please. So here's a high-level summary of the AADL error model annex. It defines an error model. An error model is basically like a state transition diagram. Error models can be associated with hardware components and software components. And I'll give an example of an error model in the later slides. Error models consist of state definitions, propagations between the states, probability that a certain transition will happen. By a transition, I mean usually a recovery or a failure, basically how often will a system fail and how long will it take to recover. We use a probability to define those numbers. And each state can be described as either working or initial or terminal. I'll describe that later when we I'll give you an example of that later when we see an example of the error annex model. Next slide. So here are the this chart basically shows the graphical representation of AADL components for both the architecture and error models. On the left side, you see a sample of the AADL graphical representation of the software and hardware components. So for software, we can describe processes, threads, data. For hardware, we can describe hardware processors, memory, buses, various hardware devices. And on the right side, you'll see these are the graphical representation, the basic building blocks of an error model. We have states, transitions, and propagations. As I described before, state is state of the component. Transition is basically how you go from one state to another.
And the thing to remember about transitions is that it does represent a component failure or recovery. And then we have something called propagation in or out. Basically, what propagation is, it's like a transition, except the difference being that the propagation is being initiated by another failure in another component, as opposed to a transition, which was self-initiated. Basically, what that means is a transition represents a component failing on its own, whereas a propagation represents a failure coming from another component that has an impact on this component. And you'll see an example of that when I go through the error models. Next slide, please. So slide 10, this is a high-level overview of how we generate the FMEA in an automatic way. We create the architecture and error models using our tool. We transform the AADL models into a Petri net. We take the Petri net and we create a raw FMEA, and we then process the FMEA results that we got from step three. And basically, this is a high-level overview, and I'll go into more details of each step in the presentation when you see an example of how all this works. Next slide. This is kind of what I said. I'll go through the FMEA generation algorithm now, slide 12. So this is our sample system. Very simple. It's a simple AADL model of a satellite. The satellite consists of two components, the bus and the payload, as you see at the very top. The bus and the payload are shown as rounded rectangles, and you see there's a connection from the bus to the payload. This is our communication pathway. Below each component is the error model. So you see below the bus has an error model called working and failed. And the payload has a similar error model. The difference in this model is that if the bus fails, it has an impact on the payload. So when the bus fails, the payload will automatically go to a standby state, and we represent this transition via a propagation. So let's see. I'm not sure you can see. There's a small triangles next to recovery and failure. Those are transitions, and the dark arrows that's next to buses down and buses up, those are propagation. So what that means is a bus is down message is being sent from the satellite bus to the satellite mod payload, and that's our propagation. So next, let's go to the next slide. So that was the AADL model, and we have a tool that then processes the AADL model and converts it into a Petri net. The bus portion of the model is shown in blue, and the payload portion is shown in pink. The states and transitions within each subsystem maps directly to corresponding error models, and the transitions shown in the ellipses correspond to the events and propagations and transitions. I guess the key point I want to make with this slide is that what you saw before on the previous slide was two separate error models. Now we have an integrated model showing how the bus and payload works together. So now that we have our Petri net, we now use this to generate our Petri tree. So let's go to slide 14. So on the left is the same Petri net that was shown in the previous diagram. Please note that there are two black dots. They represent tokens in the left-hand states of bus working and payload working. This represents the starting state of the system with the bus and payload both working. The Petri net state or marking is shown on the right as the first node of the Petri tree. And as you can guess from this model, a Petri tree represents the combined markings of a Petri net. In this case, it represents bus working and payload working. Let's go to slide 15. Now this slide shows the first firing or transition of the Petri net. As you may notice, the token moved from the bus working to the bus failed state, as shown in the, kind of a yellow sun thing. And this transition resulted in a new marking for the Petri net. As you see here, we are now in the bus failed / payload working state. If we go to the next slide, you see the effect of what happened when the bus failed. So as a result of the bus moving to a failed state, the payload standby bus down transition is now enabled, as you can see from the blue arrow, and the payload tokens and the payload token moved from the working state to standby state. This new marking is shown in the picture tree on the right as the third state that's currently highlighted of bus failed and payload standby. So let's go to the next slide. So in this slide, we see the token moving from the bus failed to the bus working state, representing a recovery. So, and which now creates a new node to Petri tree called bus working and payload standby. And when we go to the next slide, we see that now that the bus has finally recovered, the payload will now transition back to a working state. However, since we already have a state called bus working and payload working, we do not need to add new node to the tree. We just go back to the top node, as you see in red. And then the algorithm now continues to search the rest of the picture net for other markings that they can add to the picture tree, and I'll show that in the next slide on 19. So now you see that we're in initial state of bus working and payload working, and now instead of the bus failing, the payload fails. And so now the payload transitions from a working state to a failed state through the payload failure transition, as you see from the blue arrow. And since this is a new marking, we create a new node in the picture tree, as you see from bus working and payload failed. Now, even though the payload is down, the bus is still working and can suffer a failure as well. So we have to represent that state as well. So when the bus fails, this causes the payload to go back to a standby state. But since we already have that state represented in the picture tree, we do not need to create a new marking. So the tree will not increase in size. But if you notice, we did add a few more transition arrows to show possible transition. Like, for example, you see on the upper right corner of the picture tree, a transition called payload recovering. So if the bus was working and the payload failed, the payload can recover on its own and we go back to our initial starting state. Or if the or we were in the bus working and payload failed state, we go back to a state where both are failed, and then we transition to a existing state. That's basically it. So basically now we created the whole Petri tree. And once we have the Petri tree, we can now walk it to create failure modes, which will be part of our FMEAs. In this tree, every failure is recoverable. So we don't have any terminating failures. And I guess that's all I want to say about this slide. So now that you see the Petri tree, we walk it from the top to the bottom and we create the failure modes. And we go to the next slide, 21. So once we have walked the entire picture tree to generate the failure modes, we can process the results using a tool that we developed to reduce the number of failure modes to a more manageable and meaningful size. And I'll go into more detail in the next couple of slides. But basically, I guess what the takeaway for this slide is I wanted to show that we have a way to process the FMA results, because our tool can generate thousands of failure modes, and looking at thousands of failure modes will take a long time, and so we need a way to reduce that size to a more manageable and much more meaningful size. So let's go to slide 22. So this slide demonstrates some of the capabilities of the FMEA post-processing tool. The tool produces tab-separated text files. We've dumped these into Excel in order to format and size the fonts for the purposes of this presentation. The top table shows the original output from the FMEA generator. The next table shows an example of renaming rules as shown in the cells that are shaded. So what that means is, if you look at the first slide, first table, you see something called bus is down. And since we realize bus is down may not have any meaning to someone, we decide to rename that to mean bus failure propagation. The final table shows the results of filtering for initial states that have no failures. So you look at the top table, you see that there were originally three failures that the FMEA algorithm found. But let's say that we were only interested in failures where the initial state was perfect, meaning no failures had already happened. So therefore, since failure 3 represented a state where the bus was working and the payload had already failed, we filtered that state out. And you know, using these filtering techniques, it reduces the FMEA general output to a number of states that is more manageable. So for example, we've done cases where we reduced a 1600-row FMEA to 40 rows, and this was a satellite system with redundant bus and payload processors. And these 40 rows would basically represent data that a person could generate manually using the manual process, but using auto, the person can see many more failure modes and figure out how else the system can fail. So you know, once they look at the filter output, then they can figure out how the system behaved using a failure, how the system behaved with a failure, and then modify design as necessary. So that's basically it for the FMEA. That's how we automatically generate FMEAs and how we filter the results. And you know, and so on the next slide, 23, I'll give some background information about our toolset. A lot of this information was presented at last year's flight workshop, but for those that were not there, I'll give a quick overview. So we have something called the Model-Driven Design Analysis Workbench Toolset, MDDA for short. It's built on top of Eclipse, and basically it's an integration of various tools that we found. So some tools came from the AADL community. Some of them were created at the Aerospace Corporation, and some came from the University of Illinois, Mobius. But basically, it's a combination of industry and academic tools that we integrate together to form this tool set. On slide 24, this diagram shows the data flow of the MDDA workbench. As you can see, we use the various tools like Topcased and Osate, and we create our models, we go through our various tool sets, and we can do a qualitative or quantitative analysis. The qualitative analysis was the FMEA generation that I just discussed. Last year, we presented a quantitative analysis where the quantitative analysis is where we can determine what the reliability of a system, the reliability slash availability of the system is. So we can say, for example, that, oh, with the failure rate being so-and-so and the recovery rate being this, the system will be up for this amount of time. And we had presented that at last year's flight workshop. Next slide, 25. This kind of goes through the quantitative analysis of what we did, of what I just said, of how we went from models to capturing like availability of the system, as you see in the lower right corner of where we did a graph of bus computer uptime and payload computer uptime versus how long it takes to recover from a failure. Slide 26, next slide, please. So far, the largest analysis to date that we've done so far consists of 26,000 failure modes. It was a much more detailed model of the satellite bus. It wasn't as simple as I presented. We had minimal architectural components. The 26,000 failure modes was about a 500 megabyte file, and some of the failure modes were fairly long. It had up to 25 effects. However, that was a lesson that we learned, that generating a failure mode, 25 effects, can be exhausting to look at and review. And so we have to be careful in how we create the models and making sure that we don't create models that we have these long effects. So some of the things that we had looked at in the past that we realized was causing us to create long failure modes was having multiple simultaneous instantaneous transitions in our models, how we do name matching with propagations. Those are details I won't go into because that's getting into reads. But I guess basically what I want to say is that you know, we developed a process that can generate a reasonable amount of FMEAs. And That's about it. Conclusions on next slide, 27. We have a new generation toolset for FMEA for space development. It's currently under development and you've seen results. We still need some more work on it. We see that this tool does have great benefits because we can now generate FMEAs multiple times throughout the life cycle as opposed to once. And doing early FMEA generation can allow us to have an early impact on the design instead of impacting design late in the life cycle. And it can help identify problems early. Future work that we're proposed to doing in order to make this an industry strength tool is we're having discussions with the AADL community about modifying the language to make it more robust. And also there's some improvements in our tool that we need to make, like, for example, syntax checker. When we generate the models, sometimes the model will create a bad syntax, and there are easy and to find those errors, I have to manually go through the model, but we should focus on having a computer do that because it'll do it much faster than me. And these are other improvements that we want to make. I think that's it for my presentation.
Brief. So this presentation is called Automated Test Case Generation. There's a case missing there for flight software. And this is actually for the CFS, the core flight software that we heard a lot about today, and Alan is one of the guys behind that. I'm Michael Lindvall, I'm number two there. Dharma, this is like a shared custody of this presentation, so we're gonna switch over in the middle. We're from the Fraunhofer Center in Maryland. We're in College Park, we're affiliated with the University of Maryland. We do applied research and tech transfer. And we have a very nice collaboration going on with the CFS team at Goddard with Dave, Nick, Alan, and Steve. And we kind of serve as some kind of IVNV, you can say. We develop new like IVNV tools and techniques and things like that. And we have this relationship with the CFS team. They send us new updates, and we get to apply our tools and techniques to the CFS. And then we have workshops and talk about the findings and how we can improve. And we've done that for many years, actually. So today we're going to talk about the test case generation. I mean, we heard a lot about testing during these days. It's been very interesting. We know that manual testing takes a lot of effort. We have to kind of put together test cases manually, like programming. We also observed that manual testing kind of miss corner cases. Many times we do a lot of happy testing. We put together test cases that kind of confirm what we know. But it's tricky to really work out the corner cases to have the test cases really go in kind of unpredicted ways and kind of really weed out unexpected behavior. Those test cases are also kind of difficult to maintain and reuse on multiple environments. They're very tied to the system under test. You can't really move them to the next system if you want to. And in addition, they're very technical. They're like, if you look at JUnit tests, for example, they're programs in themselves, and you can't really show them to the product manager, and people cannot kind of participate in the discussion to understand what does this test case really test. And then if you have 10 test cases like that, what is the sum of these test cases? What can you really say? We can talk about code coverage, but that's something else. We also would like to talk about what kind of testing have we done here, and based on that, what can we say about the system? Are we confident in the system? So we would like to bring the discussion up a level so more people can participate and make it clearer what we're actually doing. And also, we're computer scientists, so we would like to automate. I mean, we're kind of lazy, so if the computer can do something, let's have the computer do it. So we looked at model-based testing, and we're kind of in between university and industry and government, so we try to pick up great university ideas and kind of package them and make them usable to a broader audience, if you will. And there's a lot of good stuff going on in model-based anything, actually. And we heard about Simulink. I think that's another good example. We also work with those kinds of models. But we feel it's kind of unpolished a little bit. It's like a PhD problem, that if you want to do apply these technologies, you also have to have a PhD coming with. So we're trying to solve the problem by to see, can we kind of do this kind of model-based testing, getting the power out of it, but without having the PhD coming with it. And so we build models of this the behavior of the system, the expected behavior, which is like good usages, but we also add evil usages. So we try to get put in off-nominal behavior in a kind of request-response kind of style. So we send a request to the system, and we monitor the response in every step. So that's what we mean by the expected results are embedded in the model. We have an oracle for every response. We know what the system will come back with. So then we can tell whether it's doing what we want or not. And then based on this model, we have a walker that kind of walks the model and generates test cases in various ways. And we built this technology in some kind of way that is independent of the underlying technology. So you can use this to generate JUnit tests, XUnit, SOAP UI, Selenium, Q-test, actually for anything. And some extra benefits, it gives a very visual representation of the system and the expected behavior. And these test cases are much more domain-oriented. So these models you can discuss with the, a project manager, and they're easier to understand. And it also provides a kind of documentation of the behavior of the system under test. So this is one example of a model. We have this hello world example. The only thing the program can do is you have these three buttons. You can click say hello, say world, or clear. But this kind of illustrates a typical model where the green represents a start. So each test case will start in the green box. And it will find one way through this model and exit in the red. So every test case is going to be like a walk through this model. So one example would be we start and start, and we know the state is hello equals false and world equals false. That's just to represent that we haven't done anything yet. We can click clear, and nothing will happen. We'll just return to that state. Then we can click world, and now world equals true and hello equals false, and then we can terminate. So that's essentially how we document this. We attach code to these transitions. So these are states and transitions, essentially. And out comes ready-to-run test cases that you don't have to modify. It sounds like magic, but Dharma will tell you more about the not yet. I just want him to wake up. In the previous presentation, he was kind of asleep, and then they say, it's your turn, and my God. So soon, yeah. So that's what we're doing. And we have states, transitions, and each test case is a path. And a test suite is a collection of test cases. So, I mean, we're also software architecture people, so we like to architect stuff in a nice way. So this is what the architecture looks like. We have this model. Then we have what we call a test monkey. And everything is based on interfaces. So we have that interface test monkey. Test monkey is the guy who bangs on the keyboard based on what he gets from the model. But he needs data. So if the system needs a name, for example, we use this for web testing. We use it to test any kind of system, actually. So say there's a field where you say, okay, I need a first name. He can go ask the data providers, like, give me a first name. And depending on whether it's an evil case or a good case, the data provider will give him kind of the right answer. And then the test monkey implementation, works through the interface to the system under test. And we've done it that way because the test execution framework, whether it's JUnit or use Selenium and JUnit or use Qtest for C, that's where we put all those dependencies. So it actually turns out that these models are very reusable because they're not at all dependent on the underlying test execution technology. So we have examples where we test for FDA regulations, for example. I don't know if you know, but Part 11, the regulations for electronic signatures and records. And so we encoded those requirements in these models, and we can move them from one system to another. They're highly reusable. So the workflow, so what we do typically is we define the test objective, which is what to test and what you want to get out of it, because there are many different aspects of testing. And we don't try to do everything in one model. We develop those models. We design and implement the monkey and the data provider. And the data provider can be more or less advanced. The simplest thing is that you have the data in just a static form. So when the monkey says, give me a first name, there is a constant, use this name. If it's a database-driven system, many web-based systems today have databases, then you also have to have a test data database that provides data in a more sophisticated way. But you use the same technology and then generate and execute the tests. And we iterate this as many times as we need. So let's talk a little about this particular example, the flight software under test. We heard quite a bit about it. It's the OSAL, the operating system abstraction layer, that part of the CFS. It really isolates the flight software from the operating systems and hardware, and it supports RTEMS, VxWorks, and POSIX compliant OSS. Well, why it's important that OSAL is bug-free? Well, a lot of missions depend on CFS. It's a reusable, very nice product line for a mission, a flight mission to reuse from. So, of course, that mission that reuses the software kind of assumes that the code is correct and it has the highest quality possible. This is the OSAL architecture, you can say. On the highest layer, you have the applications, the apps, but you also have tests on that level. The next layer is the OSAL interface. So it's very nice because someone who programs using this doesn't have to care about the underlying operating system. It programs to the OSAL. And then later, you can decide whether it's, are you going to use POSIX, then it will bind to the POSIX wrapper. Are you using RTMS, then it binds to that wrapper or to VxWorks. So it's very interesting because it's abstracted up. So you, as a programmer, you expect the same kind of behavior from the OSAL API kind of independently of the underlying OS. So that's very interesting for testing. And now, Dharma, it's time to wake up.
Are you able to hear me? Oh, thank you. I'm going to continue Michael's discussion on OSAL and how we apply MBD on OSAL layer. We developed a model of the file system part of the OSAL. The previous slide has shown that the OSAL has support for file systems, tasks, queues, semaphores, etc. We picked the file system to start with. So we created a test monkey with abstract actions, like we can tell to the monkey to create a file which is valid. That means the file name is valid. We know that the OSAL should return success in that case. And create file invalid means we will give it some junk name, for example, the file name that has that starts with some weird characters, for example, for which we expect the return code to be, you know, not successful. So we developed this list of actions, what we call abstract actions. And then we created a data provider. The data provider is the one who helps us. For example, we ask, please give me a file, and he put together a file name and give it to us. We can also say, please generate some contents. For example, if you want like to do file I/O, we need contents in the file. And those activities are taken care of by the data provider, a part of the architecture. Actually, once we developed this model, we generated several hundred, in fact, innumerable number of test cases, because it's, you can keep on traveling the model once you have it. For the test execution purposes, we have used the Q-test framework, which is I think C unit test, it becomes Q-test. You could actually use any of your favorite test execution technology. In fact, the CFS team has their own assertion-based test framework. We were thinking in the future to apply the same testing technique using the assertion library. That's something in the future. In the earlier slides, Michael mentioned this kind of a high-level model of the system under test. So in this case, you can see right away that we are modeling something to do with directories. We can create directories, remove directories. We can do some operations with the directories. There are some special notations in this particular model. If I can use the pointer successfully, yes, great. So you see that some nodes have a plus. That means they have submodels in it. So we kind of organize the model in a hierarchical fashion. We can go inside each submodel and do further decomposition. At the highest level, we say, OK, let's start with, maybe we start here. We do remove directory. Once we remove directory, we have several options. We can come down, either successfully removing or unsuccessfully removing. And then we can go back and start making directory operations. We can come down, again go up, and go here. Either you can make directory that's valid or invalid. And you'll keep on doing this several times you wanted. So we put together this a state machine model that will explore the directory part of the OSL layer. And to generate C test cases for us in the end. Okay, let's take one simple example here. We have the make directory API. It says there's a routine called os_makedir, pretty readable. We have a path and the access permission. And you have the documentation that explains, okay, if you pass the path as null, then if the path is null, the return code is invalid pointer. If the path is too long, you will get too long error code. So you can see what are the different possible error codes you would expect for this particular routine. So now I'm zooming inside the make directory submodel and show you a little portion of that. So there are two options, right? You can make a directory which you're sure should be valid. That means you are giving a proper name. Another possibility is you try with several options, like you pass the null pointer to that make directory routine, or create a so lengthy file name, directory name, and pass it to that and see whether those functions work correctly. So those off-nominal cases are hidden inside this portion of the. Oh, where is the? I lost the signal. Oh yeah, here it is. So all these evil cases, like passing a null pointer or passing too long, are hidden here. And this is the good one. This side is a good one. And we have a code binding, if you see. We said open valid directory. Well, what does it really mean by open valid directory? We bind it to our own monkey call. We call it open directory valid. So the traversal algorithm will print that code, basically, when it traverses the graph. So we'll get, in the end, a C code, you know. Instead of printing the text open valid directory, it will take the associated binding and print it. So we will get very different kind of combinations which you would not have thought of when we do manual testing. That's the key point. And a generated test case, which is probably hard to believe, we didn't modify anything here. We just got something like that we could right away run. For example, here, because it's generated, the names are not so great. For example, this particular thing says test OSL file system min underscore 2. 2 is the running number. Another test case could be 3. Another test case could be 4 anyways. That's one limitation, of course. You cannot get good names when you're doing model-based testing. But this is not for human to read it anyways. This is to just run it. When it fails, you go back and see what happens. So the instructions were, we are making a file system which we are sure should be is valid, and then we are checking the assertion using the qt assertion library, and then we mount the file system, and then we do open directory, and then we remove directory. There was a list of code snippets like that for each test case. So briefly give you the a summary of issues that were detected using this technology. Overall, OSL is a very high-quality product. We could only find a few issues in that file system model that we developed. Issues found when running the POSIX implementation, yes, I must say that. The OSL architecture has wrappers for VXWorks, for RTEMS, and as well as for POSIX. At Fraunhofer, the place where we work, we have only access to the POSIX implementation, the execution environment, I mean. So the plan is to rerun the generated tests at Goddard on different platforms. Anyways, coming back to the issues, one of the issues that we discussed with with the developer of OSL is that our test case failed in this scenario because we created a file system, we kept on opening files, and then we deleted the file system, again started creating new files. The system ran out of file descriptors, because it turned out that the system is keeping track of the list of file descriptors, and it didn't clean up that scenario, though. So the file descriptors were not cleaned when you're deleting the file system. So it quickly ran out of file descriptors for the new tests. So the tests started failing after several hundred files were opened. Example, I think, is this is a corner case. Probably a manual test would not consider the scenario of deleting the file system and see whether everything got cleaned up. Was detected by this technique because it was doing this traversal in a crazy way anyways, random testing, basically. We let the test generator walk through our model in a random way. OK, great. We found some other issues like this. Some of them are not surprising for the developers because they know already some of the routines were not implemented. So there's a mismatch between the expected return code and the actual return code. And some were probably surprising. Like, for example, the expected code was success when you're checking for a file system that's valid, but the actual was, there was this, here it is. We have a actual implementation says too long error code, but the documentation somewhere said only FS error. So there's a mismatch between the expected and actual return code. And they are already reported and taken care in the current versions. So we talked some good words about MBD. Of course, we should also talk about some limitations. MBD requires specification. So if we don't have specification, it doesn't really work. But I think this is a common limitation for any testing, any black box testing. Ours is a black box testing. We program to the, our models are programmed to the API of the OSL. And of course, developers are not used to modeling. They're used to programming. So there were some, we need to do some training, actually. But surprisingly, the techniques seem to be very simple, actually. We let a couple of interns who are doing undergraduate in computer science and mathematics, they were able to put together models for us, actually, in fair amount of time, in one day of training or something like that. So it has some hope. Another problem we see is that it's difficult to document the generated test cases. Each test case cannot be individually documented because we don't know what is inside the test case. We have only the general characterization in the model. Some customers are asking for documentation of each test case. So that's something we have to be aware of. Well, we have got evidence that MBD works for API-based testing. That's what we did. And it can detect some critical errors like that. MBD still requires manual work. It's not a magic. So we have to construct models, construct the monkey and data providers, and think about the architecture of the whole thing, and maintenance of the artifacts. However, the benefit is that test cases are automatically generated, and we get test cases that we would not have otherwise developed. We are still evaluating, comparing the tests that we did so far is at the OSL level layer. If you recall the CFS architecture that was discussed yesterday and today, there are other layers. So we are considering one possible feature avenue to be applying it on other layers of the CFS architecture. And also thinking about the ROI estimation. Maybe in the first iteration, MBD doesn't really outperform the manual effort in terms of the number of hours we put together. But as a regression test suite, overall, it can benefit because whenever we want new features, we go back and rework the model and come up with new combinations of test cases. Still, you have to think about the ROI in the future. I think we are close to the end. This project between Fraunhofer and NASA Goddard is supported, in fact, by the NASA SARP program. Lisa Montgomery is the project program manager. And we are grateful for her support. And we also like to acknowledge Sally at Goddard, who introduced us to several projects over there. And thank you all for attending to this talk. And this is the list of acronyms we need to give for approval. And thank you.
Are there any questions? Yes.
Would you say that you do extensive, full coverage testing, or are there some paths unexplored, and do you have a way of characterizing, percent coverage?
So
exhaustive was the word I was looking for.
So there are two types of coverage, right? One is requirements-oriented coverage, and this code-oriented coverage. The technique that we have pursued here is at more a black box point of view. So it may not make sense directly to measure lines of code and compare it with this one, because we take a requirements-oriented viewpoint. The source code has so many other details that we probably have not modeled. And it mixes with, say take your OSL layer. It has several modules, and we only model a small portion of the OSL, like file system API. So we should, if you really wanted to measure the coverage, we should limit ourselves to those files of the OSL file system module. We did measure the coverage. I don't remember the number exactly, but it's in a preliminary stage, I must say.
And what about in terms of the input space?
So there are two types of input, right? One is the sequencing. I open the file, several options. I can close it right away. I can do some read and write. Those things are taken care of in the model. The model is taking care of the sequencing. There is another type of input is data. So you open a file, what type of data are you going to write? You can write numbers, you can write characters. Maybe the program behaves differently if your file ends with a new line, an extra line is there. So that's taken care of by the data provider. What happens is that because of this architecture where we have iMonkey asking the iData provider to give the data, the same test case can be executed on different data. It asks, when we do random testing, we get duplicate tests, same tests exactly coming more than once, but they run in different ways because the data provider is giving different type of data. So it is still in a part of research to understand how the data and the control is working together. We haven't fully solved. It's a research project for next 3 years.
All right, thanks.
Yeah.
This actually becomes important. There's about 20 people dialed in listening.
Thank you. Just for the record, if I understand this correctly, is this unit testing that you're doing here?
Or is it
at a higher level?
So the technique itself is flexible for different types of testing. Like Michael said, we also did complete black box testing of web-based systems. We don't know how the system is architected. We don't know the APIs and stuff like that. In this case, we used the API of OSL, and we don't know how the implementation is really working. Of course, we look at the implementation when a test fails, but the technique itself is at the APA level, application programming interface level. I don't know whether you would like to call it black box or gray box, but it is not really at the implementation level. It's at the interface level.
Okay, thank you.
Sure.
there more questions? Oh, there you are.
So you said that you have access to the POSIX version of OCEL. I was wondering if you had any plans or future plans to look at the RTEMS or the VxWorks implementations.
Yeah, we would like to run RTEMS and VxWorks at Fraunhofer. We had some technical challenges on installing those versions. So we are in collaboration with the CFS team to take our test cases and run it at Goddard. That's one possibility. And if their time and schedule permits, to have a version running in Fraunhofer as well. So we have access, of course, OCEL is open source. Yes. Then we will know whether a test case passed in this version and failed in this version or vice versa. That will be interesting to see.
Any other questions? No? Very good. Thank you.
Thank you.